So I think we're ready to go, Maureen.
All right, I have started the recording.
All right, the appointed hour is 6 o'clock, having been reached, I want to welcome everybody to this meeting of the Amherst Zoning Board of Appeals. Pursuant to Governor Baker's March 12th, 2020 order, suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, general laws, chapter 30A, section 18, and the governor's March 15th, 2020 order imposing strict limitations on the number of people that may gather in one place. This public hearing of the Town of Amherst Zoning Board of Appeals is being conducted via remote participation. No in-person attendance of members of the public will be permitted, but the public can listen to the proceedings by clicking on a link on the town's webpage. In accordance with provisions of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 48, Article 10, Special Permit Granting Authority, the Amherst Zoning Bylaw, this public meeting has been duly advertised and notice thereof has been posted and mailed to parties at interest. My name is Steve Judge. As Chair of the Zoning Board of Appeals, I call this meeting to order. The Zoning Board of Appeals is a quasi-judicial body that operates under the authority of Chapter 48 of the General Laws of the Commonwealth. For the purpose of promoting the health, safety, convenience, and general welfare of the inhabitants of the town of Amherst. One of the most important elements of the zoning bylaws is section 10.38. Specific findings from this section must be made for all our decisions. There are copies of 10.38 available for the public's use on our website. All hearings and meetings are open to the public and are recorded by town staff. The procedure is as follows. The petitioner presents the application to the board during the hearing, after which the board will ask questions for clarification or additional information. After the board has completed its questions, the board will seek public input. The public speaks with the permission of the chair. If a member of the public wishes to speak, they should so indicate by using the raise hand function on their screen. The chair, with the assistance of the staff, will call upon people wishing to speak. When you are recognized, present your name and address to the board for the record. All questions and comments must be addressed to the board. The board will normally hold public hearings where information about the project and input from the public is gathered, followed by public meetings for each. The public meeting portion is where the board deliberates and is generally not an opportunity for public comment. If the board feels it has enough information and time, it will decide upon the applications tonight. Each petition is heard by the board is distinct and evaluated on its own merits, and the board is not ruled by precedent. Statutorily, for a special permit, the board has 90 days from the close of its hearing to file a decision. For a variance, the board has 100 days from the date of filing to file its decision. No decision is final until the written decision is signed by the board members and is filed with the town clerk's office. Once the decision is filed with the town's clerk, there is a 20-day appeal period for an aggrieved party to contest the decision with the relevant judicial body and superior court. After the appeal period, the permit must be recorded at the registry of deeds to take effect. Tonight, we have the following agenda. Zoning Board of Appeals rules and regulations. To review the Zoning Board of Appeals rules and regulations in order to bring them into compliance with the Amherst Home Rule Charter and to review necessary updates. This is continued from May 28th, and I'm going to move this item to the end of the agenda so that we may deal with the two petitions first and then deal with our rules and regulations after that. ZBA FY 2020-38, RC Retail Amherst LLC. A request a special permit for use of a recreational marijuana retailer under sections 3.363.2, 7.9, and 10.38 of the Amherst Zoning Bylaw, located at 328 College Street. Map parcel 14B, parcel 222, and map 15A, parcel 97, commercial zoning district. Second is ZBA FY 2020-37, Fitterman Family Limited Partnership, request a special permit to allow an increase in the number of residential units, converted dwellings from 1 to 2 under section 3.324 and 10.38, located at 152 Logtown Road, map 18D, parcel 303, neighborhood RN Residential District. After the meeting, we have a public comment period where we'll take comments from the public on any item not included on our agenda or business for the night. Tonight we will have sitting for each panel the regular members of the ZBA. We have also asked our new associate members to join us tonight. This is not something that we will do every time, but we want to make sure to give them the opportunity to view hearings and meetings in person, and to feel comfortable when they are called on to serve as voting members of a given panel. Tonight, I'd like to have a roll call vote for our regular members who are in attendance. Steve Judge is here. Ms. O'Meara, are you here?
Jo needs to unmute herself. I'll try to do that for you, Joan. Hold on. Hold on a second, Joan.
I think we lost.
Joan, you can speak now. Nope, she muted herself again. Okay, I'm gonna press the button, Joan. Okay, you did it. Nope, do it again. Okay, Joan, go ahead, Joan.
I can see you're there, Joan. So we're going to record you as attending here, and unless we hear from you again. All right.
She's going in and out of mute and not mute.
But I can see her name on the list. Ms. Parks?
Here.
Mr. Langsdale?
Here.
Mr. Maxfield?
Here.
And associate members, Mr. Barrick?
Here.
Mr. Meadows?
Here.
And Mr. Greeny?
Here.
Great. Tonight with us, we have town staff. Maureen Pollock is here. I think, is Dave from the plant, from the inspection division, also here?
Dave is here.
Dave Wakasevich. Great. Is there anybody else from the town staff in attendance?
Not right now.
Okay. Good enough, and we can begin our meeting. The first order of business, and before I begin, we received one lessee certification, a requirement that of the zoning bylaws that the if we're dealing with a special permit and it involves tenants currently in the property, that they have to be notified in advance of this hearing, and that we need to get certification from the property owner manager that has been delivered and that been delivered to the tenant. We do have that for the RC retail. We don't have a signed representation from Fitterman Family Limited Partnerships for FY 2020-37. We can discuss that when that comes up as an item when we're dealing with that issue. So we should begin with RC Retail Amherst LLC, ZBA FY 2020-38. We did conduct a site visit at the on Monday evening. Site visit was attended by most of the members of the panel.
Here.
Joan is here.
There you go, Joan. All right, the site visit, we asked several questions. At first, we reviewed the property. We walked around the lot. We saw the place where the parking would take place. We observed the approximate lot lines. We've also observed the proposed employee entrance. We viewed the building through the windows. We did not enter the windows, or did not enter the building. We observed a delivery area, fencing around the delivery area during delivery, and the roll-down blinds, or for lack of a better term, the roll-down structures that would protect from view delivery vehicles. And that was pretty much the questions asked during the site visit. Does any members of the panel have other questions that they think should be noted and make sure we're asked at this hearing? Okay, if not, we do also have the following submissions from the applicant that we've received. Those submissions include a special permit application, a management plan, project description and details, evidence of submission to the Cannabis Control Commission, a binding letter of intent for site control and option to lease, notarized state of representatives, property owner authorization, abutter proximity zoning compliance plan, ZBA special permit set, which includes a cover sheet, property plan, site prep and layout, site grading and details, floor plan, site photos, security cover sheet and base drawing, burglar alarms drawings, access control cameras, photometric lighting plans, light fixtures, schedules and cut sheets, A&R plan prepared by Randall Iser, lighting specifications, a traffic impact statement prepared by McMahon Associates, proposed findings developed by staff or by the applicant. We also have a letter and an email, excuse me, we have emails from the police chief and the fire department with their comments. And on June 5th, we received an email from Tom Reedy, dated June 5th. And we also received a parking utilization assessment. So with that, that details our site visit and the documents before us as a board. I'd like to turn it over to the applicant for the presentation. And then we will move to questions from the panelists and then response from the applicant and questions from the public.
Tom and Stan, I've made you panelists. So now you can unmute your microphone and you can turn your video on. And Tom, you can share your screen.
Perfect. Thank you. Also, we've got Chris Farley here, our architect. He doesn't necessarily, he's going to speak. I don't know that he needs to share his screen because I'll be controlling that. And then we've got our traffic engineer as well. So as we get to that point, you know, you can obviously make the decision whether or not you want to make them panelists or just listeners. So
sure. I don't see Chris here. And who is the other person?
Jason Adams from.
Yeah, Jason Adams. Yeah, I have Jason. Okay. I can go ahead and make him a panelist. And
okay.
He can...
And then Jeff Robler.
Yep. Okay. I'll make him a panelist. Both Jeff and Jason, you can just keep yourself muted without the video if you want. And then I don't see Chris. It does say total 3 phone call-in listeners. Unfortunately, I think if Chris, if you're listening, if you could log in with the link, that might be better. I don't, because he's not here, at least.
Okay, yeah, I think he tried. He said he got an error message that he had never got before. So he was, Chris, if you're listening, maybe try again. And then if you can.
Yeah, someone, it says someone's raising their hand, but for some reason I can't see who's. Oh, Chris Farley, I see you, Chris. Haha. Okay, Chris, I'm going to pull you up as a panelist as well. Thank you. Okay, you're all set.
Beautiful. Thanks a lot. The world we're living in. And this is going to be the first time I'm sharing a screen, so I'm going to also ask for everybody's patience. Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Ms. Pollack, Mr. Waskevich. I'm Tom Reedy. I'm an attorney with Bacon Wilson here in Amherst, here on behalf of RC Retail. And its application for a special permit for a recreational marijuana retailer at 328 College Street here in Amherst. With me this evening, Jeff Robler, the Director of Operations and Constructions for RC Retail, Salvatore Carabetta Jr., the Operations Manager, and the Honorable Stan Rosenberg, who's RC Retail's Community Liaison. We've also got, as mentioned, Jason Adams, traffic engineer from McMahon Associates, and Chris Farley, the architect for this project from Kuhn Riddle. So I think what I want to do is talk a little bit about the background. This project has been in the works for over a year. So in April of 2019, the town published a request for interest for adult use marijuana establishments in town. In May of that year, 2019, RC Retail responded. And in August 6th, they held a community outreach meeting at the Lord Jeff, or Boltwood Inn as it's now known, and then had a town review committee meeting with the former town economic development director, the police chief, the health director, Julie Fetterman, Connie Kruger, who was formerly on the select board, and then Chris Brestrup. And after going through, you know, after having the project reviewed, having the community outreach meeting, and then being through the town review, the town invited or selected this project to proceed. And so then we negotiated with the town a host community agreement, and we signed that host community agreement at the end of September of last year. In October of last year, Stan Rosenberg went door to door to all the shopping centers, or all the tenants of the shopping center, and also the retail space, that mixed use space at the rear of the site, and also door to door for the residential dwelling units in the neighborhood, invited them all to an October 13th meeting just to make sure that everybody knew what was going on. Now, since that time, we've been planning and designing this site, and it's really just the interior workings of it. We've had meetings with Maureen, with Rob Moore, with Chris Brestrup over those months. And as we were gearing up, and actually had submitted back in December, Rob Moore, in his review of the application, noticed that there was an old permit associated with the site. And let me see if I can start doing this and what this looks like. Drum roll, please. Maureen, I think it's going to kick me out, and then I'll have to
come. Okay, what do you want? What do you mean?
Unless you have it.
What do you want to show?
I was just going to show, I mean, I've got the aerial to show.
I have a property map, like a property map?
Yeah, like a GIS property map.
Sure, yeah.
And then if you have the special permit stuff, just because my computer is going to make me quit and then come back if I'm going to share the screen, because I just have to give it privacy.
Okay, all right. So I am going to, hold on a second.
Hmm. Or I could just, why don't you let me back in? Oh, that's good.
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. So what Rob Mora realized was that 15A24, 15A97, and 14B222, the parcel references, are all subject of a site plan review approval that was issued by the planning board back in, I think, 1998. And so while these appear as separate parcels on the assessor's map, under that approval, they are actually, they were considered one parcel. And so it was his opinion that we first had to make sure that, probably divide those parcels and amend that site plan approval. So having recognized that, in April of this year, we actually got the planning board approval for that separation. So there is a lot one and a lot two. And Maureen, I don't know if you have that A&R.
Yep. Okay, so hold on a second. Let me find that. Okay, so I'm gonna pull up yesterday's A&R.
Perfect.
Window view, this counter, this.
Nice job. Right.
New share. Can you see it or?
Yes.
No. Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. Nice job. So you'll see that while there were three assessor's parcels, though considered one for the purposes of permitting, we were able to successfully receive the approval from the planning board for this division that you see. So now there is a lot one where the shopping center will exist, and a lot two where that mixed use center will exist. And so the mixed use is comprised of residential and commercial space. In both of, now that we have both of those spaces, we're able to only address lot one, which is this, really the subject of this special permit. This plan has been recorded at the Registry of Deeds. It has not been picked up yet by the assessor's map. So I think that's why in your, in the application and in the publication in the newspaper, you include those former 15A97 and 14B222, even though when you make your decision, and hopefully it's an approval, it will only be dealing with lot one as shown on the plan. And I think there's just a lag time between the registry and your assessor's map. So we've been through the planning board, successfully divided the lots, and that lot division also, and Maureen, if you could zoom in just a little bit, please. Perfect. So as you know, under your zoning bylaw, marijuana uses have to be beyond 500 feet property line to property line from any K-12 educational use. And so Fort River School, the entrance to Fort River School, if you're familiar with Southeast Street, after if you're traveling north on Southeast Street between the intersection right by the Northampton Cooperative Bank, just beyond that is the driveway entrance to Fort River School. And so while the school is set back, the property line of the school is up at Southeast Street. Measuring from that point out, you'll see the red dashed line on this A&R plan. That is the five, thanks Maureen, perfect. That is the 500 foot buffer line. And so lot two is within that buffer. And so we thought it was important to make sure that the marijuana use, so the sale of the marijuana, is outside of or on a parcel outside of that 500 feet. So that's the first piece. Your bylaw also requires that you, that the marijuana use exist 300 feet away from certain uses, residential uses, for example. There are residential uses to the north, there are residential uses to the west, residential uses to the east. You'll see that that light blue kind of teal color shows the 300 foot buffer from any of those disqualifying uses. And so what we've done and what Chris Farley will talk about is the design of the interior of this space, ensuring that the marijuana use exists outside of the 300 foot buffer zones. And so with that, Maureen, if you wanna go to the, just the special permit site plan app, permit set, if you would.
Sure.
Because what we're proposing is for approximately 900 square foot recreational marijuana retailer space with about 370 square feet open to the public. And so what I'll do now is I'll turn it over to Chris Farley to talk through the site design and especially the interior design for this project. Of course, feel free to stop us, ask us any questions that you have. And Maureen, in the interim, I'll probably hop off, hop back on just in case I need to control anything going forward.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Chris Farley. I'm an architect with Kuhn Riddle Architects in Amherst. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. I'm up in Ashfield, and there is sometimes a delay, so I'll apologize if I talk over anyone or if there's any problem with that. I think the first thing I'd like to do is to talk about the tenant space organization that Tom alluded to, and then I'd like to talk about the exterior experience, and then talk about the interior experience. Maureen, if you could zoom in a bit.
Is there another page that...
Essentially what's happening, I think that's fine from my point of view, as long as everybody else can clearly see it. So the tenant space is a long narrow space from the front of the building all the way to the back. You'll see on this drawing red dashed arcs. Those are the relevant 300 foot residential buffer arcs. And essentially, all of the dedicated marijuana uses have to be outside of those arcs. So what we've done is we've created a retail marijuana store in the very front of the tenant space that is just outside all of those arcs. And then in the middle of the tenant space, there is what we are calling shared space. And that is space that is to be used by potentially by the staff of the Red Cardinal store, but also by the staff or employees of the rear rental space. So it's common space. It is not dedicated to the marijuana use. And we've reviewed this with the town, so we have these three distinct zones. The front is marijuana, the middle is common space, and the rear would be for another tenant, as yet to be determined. So let's see, Maureen, if you could just zoom out a little bit so we could see College Street and the curb cuts there. I'll talk a little bit about the exterior experience and some of the exterior features. That's great. So you'll see at the bottom right of the drawing, there's an in and an out symbol. This curb cut onto College Street is intended to be the primary vehicular access point. There's a line of parking that you can see along the side of the building. It's the left side of parking that kind of marches up the drawing here. That is where we imagine, thank you, Maureen. That's where we imagine most customers will park. It's off to the side. It doesn't compete with any of the front parking spaces, which are really better suited to the other tenants in this building, the other retail tenants. So someone in a vehicle would come in, they would park in one of those spaces. And there's an existing sidewalk on the east side of the building. We're going to be doing some relatively minor elevational adjustments to that sidewalk, repaving and raising it up a bit to make the retail space fully accessible. But the location of the curb, the location of the sidewalk is going to be exactly as it is now. There are just some minor adjustments in elevation, which will be required to make the space fully accessible. So a person would come into a park in one of those spaces, walk up that side sidewalk, and there's an entry door and an exit door under cover in the front of the store. And maybe Maureen, now would be a good time to go to the plan, which is, I think it's two or three sheets forward from this one.
Let's see, what is this? This?
A little further.
Next page, next sheet.
This is the one right here. If you could just scroll to the left a bit.
Oh, this, to the right, to the left. I'm gonna zoom out.
There we go.
Do you want this page or a different page?
The previous page with the plan on it.
That's not a plan. That's a floor plan.
The floor plan.
Oh, okay.
Yep. Can I just ask really quickly that?
There we go.
Can people please mute themselves who are not speaking? Because I mean, I hear a lot of background noise. I don't know if anyone else hears that.
I think it sounds like a tea kettle boiling.
Yeah.
I think that might be coming from Maureen.
Oh, okay.
I'm not making tea. There's no tea. But I'll mute myself.
All right.
So Maureen, if you could just zoom in just to the floor plan on the top of the page. That's excellent. Thank you. So there's an existing walkway just to the below the exterior wall of the building. A customer would come in, take a right. There's an area right in the front of the store labeled deliveries. And right to the right of that, there's an entry door, security vestibule. That's where IDs will be checked. There'll be an ATM there for customer use. Once somebody is cleared, they would go from the security vestibule into the queue, the customer queue. If there's a line of people, when the person is to the front of the line, they would go to one of the five point of sale stations near the top of the drawing. And then once they've done their business, they would leave through an exit door to the delivery area and then back out to the sidewalk and to wherever they've parked. Now, one of the things I want to point out here is there are three different hatches, textures, patterns on this drawing. The white, the interior white space, that's the public space. The cross-hatched space is the staff space. And so there's a security room, there's an operations room, point of sale, there's a couple of operation spaces on the right-hand side of the drawing, another space just below the queue. And then there's just a gray tone space. Those are the common spaces. And you can see that those are inside the 300-foot residential buffer zone. And all of the dedicated marijuana spaces are outside the 300-foot residential buffer zone. There's an exterior door from the sidewalk that goes into the common vestibule. Presumed to be the staff entry for both tenant spaces, both Red Cardinal and the rear tenant. There's a shared bathroom, there's a shared conference room, and a shared utilities and storage space. And then to the right of this, through another door from the common vestibule, is where the rear tenant space is. And that's just got a single hatch to represent that. So that's primarily the customer flow through the space and the separation between marijuana use, shared use, and the rear tenant use. Maureen, maybe you could go to the next page that shows the exterior views. Okay, great, thank you. So there are a couple of photographs on the top that show existing conditions with some dotted lines and some white highlights that show the tenant space that we're talking about and that show the existing features of what we're talking about. So the intention here is that the modifications we intend to make is to, is to maintain a covered front area. However, we do intend to put a low stone wall in the very front of the building. And we will be doing some reconstruction on the roof directly above. There is currently an open skylight into the space that we see, into that covered front space that we see as a security conflict. So we're going to be filling that in, creating a more secure roof, and at the same time, creating a new vertical parapet, that will replace the sloped shingled portion of the roof, the mansard roof. That's where we'll be putting some primary signage. And then there'll be a canvas awning that will go across the entire front of the store and down the side of the store to that common entry, common space entry. So during inclement weather, if there is any queuing outside, that can happen undercover. So you can see in this rendering, there's a low stone wall in front that is going to make sure that everybody enters that covered entry from the side. The entry door is just behind that corner column, and then the exit door is to the left. There's a secondary sign in between those two doors. And then the facade of the building underneath that cover is intended to be a new wood or some sort of a wood product facade. It's a material that we hope to tie in with some of the interior finishes, and it's a way to make the facade a little more engaging, a little a little warmer. The rest of the wall that goes down, the existing wall that goes down the side of the building, is an existing concrete block that's going to be maintained, but it will be painted. There are a couple of large windows in the side of the building you can see in this rendering. We intend to fill in about 3/4 of those windows, again, for security reasons. However, we're going to be maintaining one small portion of window. There'll be new glazing that's installed with a security film so that people cannot see in, but it will transmit light into that security vestibule. Now, the other thing you'll see here, excuse me, on this rendering just below the canvas awning on the side of the building, you can see a series of gray rectangles. Those are LED wall packs, lighting, that will light the walkway on the side of the building as well as the parking up to the side of the building. Thank you, Maureen. Those are the lights. And these lights have a throw that goes out just a little bit beyond the end of the parking spaces. So the entire parking sequence, getting out of your car, walking into the building and coming back, will be well illuminated. And then on the left-hand side of this rendering, you can see a parking space with the symbol of accessibility on the ground. And then a loading zone. That's some of the elevational changes we'll be making in the walkway so that there's a dedicated accessible parking space, adjacent loading zone. It would allow someone with a disability or someone in a wheelchair to easily make their way into the building in a fully accessible route from that parking space. And then also the walkway continues to the left in front of all the other existing stores, and that walkway will remain unchanged. I think one of the things, Maureen, I'd like to talk about is site lighting. So we talked about the sign lighting, the wall packs on the side. There are also on the ceiling of this covered entry area, we have some downlights so that entire front of the building, or I'm sorry, front of the store and that area undercover, that will be well lit as well.
Chris, a quick question. What is up here above the word Red Cardinal and the long rectangular
that is a
feature?
Sure. That's a linear light fixture, which is intended to illuminate the sign.
Okay, I can see that now. Thank you.
Thank you for asking about that. And actually, Maureen, before we go to a different drawing to talk about the site lighting, I'd like to talk a little bit about secure deliveries in this front area. So, what we have proposed is, and you can see in the curb, there's a curb cut or kind of an easing of the curb.
Excuse me.
Mr. Yes. Langsdale?
Mr. Farley, you began to talk about the lighting, excuse me, under the overhang there before Mr. Judge asked you about the lighting on the red cardinal sign. Could you go ahead and talk about the lighting underneath the overhang, please?
Absolutely. So as part of the reconstruction of this ceiling area to close in that open area, skylight area, there'll be a new ceiling and there'll be six recessed lighting fixtures that are spread out in two rows of three. That will illuminate the entire area in front of that wood facade above that covered entry. So that will be a well-lit area that will help to illuminate the sign as well as the entry and the exit doors.
Thank you, Mr. Farley.
And as long as we're on that subject, Mr. Farley, it looks like the light extends into the parking lot and then also into the parking in lot two as well. Is that on purpose? I see when I look at your lighting plans, I see positive numbers up to 2.8 for, looks like it's across both parking lanes. Is that correct?
That is correct. And
okay.
Maureen, if you could go to the last sheet in this set that shows the photometric plan, excuse me. I apologize, it's a little difficult to see. I'm sorry, it's the second to last sheet, thank you. It's a little hard to see, but directly in front of this store, if you go all the way to the left, there's a new lighting fixture that will be in the island between the parking in front of the store and College Street. It's shown in red. Yes, right there. So that's an 18-foot pole-mounted LED parking lot light. And that will illuminate the front of the store, help to illuminate the parking in front of the store, as well as to some extent, the walkway in front of the store. And then you can see also in this drawing, and I apologize, I think it's 10 recessed light fixtures in the ceiling. You can see them as black dots. In the entry area, two rows of five. Those are the LED downlights to illuminate that entry area. And then Maureen, if you could scroll down and zoom out a little bit on the bottom of this photometric plan, there are three additional 18-foot pole-mounted parking lot lights. They are identical to the one in front of the store. They're the same height. And you can see they're the same red rectangles with the lighting identification number. And what this will do is it will illuminate that side of the parking lot and the travel lane between the two rows of parking. Without that, the wall packs, LED wall packs on the side wall of the store, they just don't project out far enough to give good illumination to the parking area, to the travel lanes of the parking area. Tom, I don't know if you want to talk about the lighting on and off the site.
I mean, I'm happy to. I think it was, so as Chris just mentioned, there's a few fixtures that are on lot two, which is obviously still owned by Mr. Paul Shumway, who owns lot one. And I think we just placed those lights there because if you recall from the site visit, there are no lights in that strip between Spirit House and the shopping center. And I think the nearest light is across the Spirit House parking lot way on the easterly side. So you know, we thought that out of an abundance of caution, just to illuminate this area, it makes a lot of sense to add those lights. So I think it's good to have them as part of this approval. If they weren't, I think they would end up going in there anyways, but they are off this lot, but I think useful for the entire shopping center.
Thanks, Tom. So I went on a little bit longer than I had intended. I apologize, but I think that covers most of the basics. I would be happy to answer any specific questions if you have them about exterior or interior features or circulation, anything like that.
I have a question. You were starting to talk about the delivery. Can you go back and speak about how that will happen?
Yes, thank you, absolutely. Maureen, if you could go to the architectural floor plan. Yes, right there. And maybe, and if you could zoom into that front area that shows deliveries and the vehicle there. So the intention here is that this covered area is meant to be not only the customer entry and exit for the retail space, but it is also going to be the secure delivery area for deliveries and pickups at the Red Cardinal store. So what's represented here in plan is a vehicle that would drive into this front space. Obviously it would be while the business is closed, there would be no customers present. But they would the vehicle would drive in for a delivery or a pickup, and then there are heavy dotted lines on three sides of this entry. There's a long one in the front, a short one where the vehicle would enter, and another short one in front of the window into the adjacent laundromat. What those dotted lines represent are motorized roll down security grills, and the intention is that when a vehicle is in there, that the roll down screens would come into position, and they would provide a secure environment for the movement of product, any sort of delivery to the store or any sort of pickup from the store would be in this very secure location with these three screens. The screens themselves are quite transparent. So not only is it easy for the delivery staff to see out and to see if there are any people or anything happening outside the secure delivery area, but because this is undercover and a vehicle is going to be driving in here, there is going to be some issue with exhaust. The openness of the security screens allows there to be some air movement so that there isn't any sort of buildup of exhaust here. The protocol would be as soon as the vehicle is in place, the engine would be shut off. And I believe this was one of the comments from the fire department that they would request that there be a sign saying, shut off engine in this location. So we would have a sign like that. And then as long as the vehicle was in there, it would be turned off as long as the transfer was being made. And then once the transfer is made securely in the vehicle or securely in the building, the roll-up security grills would come up, the vehicle would exit that area, and that's how that transfer would take place.
So I have a follow-up question. Do you have any concern about gas and oil being on the surface, which would be the entrance where people are walking? What kind of medium will you be using?
Well, the intention is that this is going to be a new concrete slab. Right now, there is a concrete walkway and some vegetative planters there. Those will be removed. There'll be a new concrete slab. I think our feeling is that vehicles will be in this location for a very short period of time. If there are any sort of drips or spills from the vehicle, I think operationally the staff will be set up to be able to put out an absorbent material to help absorb any of that material and do a cleanup before customers would be entering the building.
Okay, and then I have just one other question. The handicap space is going to be moved around. Is that space available for people going to other businesses there? It's just open. All of the parking is open to whoever is there.
You've got it. Yeah. So that's because right. of the, this is a pretty unique situation because of the shopping center, there's no exclusive parking for any use. So that ADA space, someone wants to park there and head to the laundromat or head to Summerlin floors. It's all fair game.
I will say, Tom, that we do have, we are indicating one accessible parking space and a loading zone. If there's any concern about not having enough accessible parking, there could be potentially one added to the other side of that. And there is another existing accessible parking space at the other end of the parking in front of the shopping center.
And also about the mailbox, is that going to be moved? It was mentioned during the site visit that it might be moved. The mailbox is currently almost right on the corner.
That's right. The intention, I've talked about this with Red Cardinal, and my understanding is the intention is Red Cardinal will talk with the USPS and find a suitable alternate location for that mailbox.
What are the exhaust systems for that delivery area? Are the requirements the same as they are for a fire station or any garage where you've got to have the doors open or an exhaust, direct exhaust?
I think because of the open nature of the security grills, I think that the security grills, I think, are 95% open. It's not really a door of any sort. It doesn't keep air out or air in. So I think the selection of that, of the very open security grill, is intended to be the ventilation method for this location. I will say one other thing related to the exhaust is that we've talked with our HVAC consultant and the security vestibule, which is where the deliveries or pickups would be happening through that entry door. The security vestibule will have a positive air pressure, so that whenever that door is open, it will create a situation where air from the inside of the building will be flowing out and will not allow the outside air, possibly contaminated with exhaust, to enter into the building.
Mr. Chair, Ms. O'Mara is raising her hand.
Oh, Ms. O'Mara.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Great. Sorry for all my technical difficulties. I have a question on the hours of operation. It's listed as Monday to Saturday, 8 to 8. I don't know if we've granted those hours before. Can you comment on that, Maureen?
I do not recall the opening hour to be that early for other marijuana dispensaries in Amherst.
But I do
imagine that the other stores have been granted to be open until 8 p.m. And please correct me. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't recall any other stores opening that early.
No,
I don't either.
Yeah,
and I'm concerned about the school.
Go ahead.
Concerned about the school buses going to Fort River. That can be a congestion in that area at that hour of the morning.
Okay.
I also have a question on that.
All right, Mr. Langsdale.
If the opening hour is 8 o'clock, and then you go till 8 o'clock in the evening, and the deliveries have to be made before or after, or both, which I'm not sure, it's not stated, then you're talking approximately like 7 in the morning to make deliveries. And while it is primarily a commercial area, there is the building that's on the property map is 15A24, which is the mixed use. So there are apartments there. One of the other questions I have, just because I don't know, is these security grills, they come down, go up. Are they noiseless or do they make a lot of rattling noise? I'm just asking in terms of if we're talking like 7 in the morning, there are people who live around there.
So maybe Mr. Reedy, if I could, Mr. Chair, I'll respond to a few of those. And I think then I'll ask Chris to discuss the sound of the grills going up and coming down. For the hours of operation, your bylaw does allow 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. I don't recall off the top of my head whether or not Rise, for example, asked for it. I think they might have asked for it while they may not open for it. You know, the entire 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. It's what the bylaw provides, so we're asking for it. As far as the neighborhood, I think we, I don't, you know, this isn't like the dumpsters are located closer to the residential units than this delivery area. It's in a commercial zone. We are, you know, we're not going to have reverse gear alarms in this area. You're pretty close to Cumberland Farms, which I think is open maybe 5 a.m. to midnight. So that's just to set the neighborhood a little bit. You know, it's not like we are in the middle of a residential neighborhood. We're on Route 9, and it's adjacent to Route 9. So I'll let Chris talk about the grills and the sounds that they make. But we think that given the fact that, yeah, there could be a delivery at 7 a.m. or 7:30 or 6:30 or 9 p.m. because they'll have to be off hours, and it's random times, random routes that these delivery vehicles will make, and unmarked delivery vehicles, obviously only a certain size because of the delivery bay that they'll be going into. But I think that's probably in concert with the Dunkin' Donuts that's right next door, or Kelly's Restaurant, which opens, I think, at 5:30 a.m. So, you know, there are some uses that actually start before when these deliveries would take place. So just for the board to keep that in mind, given this location. And Chris, maybe if you'll talk about the grills and the sound.
Sure. So these are electric motorized grills. So they will be coming down and going up relatively slowly because that's the nature of how the electric motors work. Most grills like this, when they're moving, there is some small amount of mechanical noise as they run up and down the side tracks. And then there is a low hum, electric hum, from the motor itself. But I don't think that this particular system and these particular grills will be loud or startling. I think it will essentially be a low hum that you'll hear when they're going up or when they're going down. And I do think that Tom's point about the location of these is a good one. This does face Route 9, College Street. Directly across the street, there's a lot of vegetation and forest. And just to the east across the street is another strip mall, another you know, business building. So I think that most of the sound from these, the movement of these security grills will be projected across College Street, not behind where the residential units are primarily, or not to the west where those residential units are.
I have a question, as long as we're dealing. Are you done with your questions, Mr. Langsdale, on that subject?
For now, yeah.
Yep. As long as we're dealing with the deliveries, I was going to wait till you're completed, but I don't want to leave the subject. One of the requirements are that your deliveries be randomized. And I think the reason for that is for security, security of delivery of the product and safety of the vehicle occupants and people in the store. This is the first time in my experience that we've had delivery out in front on a major, on Route 9, out in front. And it can only be either before 8 o'clock in the morning, so 4, 5, 6, 7 o'clock in the morning, or 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night, or in the middle of the night. So you have 12, half your day you can't make a delivery. It makes randomization half as random as it otherwise would be. Other places, in the other places that we've approved, have delivery in the back or someplace where it could happen anytime when the store is open. But that can't happen here. You can't do it when the store is open. So I'm wondering how you randomize the deliveries without having people in the stores to accept them, which then signals to whoever you care about the reason that you put the shutters around the vehicle. Talk to me about how you ensure that you have, this is going to be safe when there's going to be at least some pattern to these deliveries. And if nothing else, if it's at night, lights in the store are going to be on, so bad folks could know that the deliveries are being made. So talk to me about that. That's my concern about the deliveries.
Sure. So I guess I think the first response is this is something that we developed in concert with Chief Livingstone. So we had looked at, we had gone through a couple of iterations, you know, citing this delivery portal somewhere else on the site. And this is where I think everybody felt it was the best location. Even though the hours of operation that we're asking for are 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., I think a couple of things. That still, A, gives us 12 hours to deliver. And you can see the size of the store. They've got, you know, some sufficient area to... marijuana products aren't that big. And, you know, my guess is, and maybe Jeff, you can jump in here. So RC Retail has its a cultivation manufacturing processing facility in that they're building out in Worcester. And I would suspect that most of the product will come from that facility. So they'll be able to control the times of the day and hours. And it may be that this happens every day, every other day. And I don't think it would be unusual for it to happen in any of those 12 hours. Now, if they find that, because, you know, safety of their employees is paramount. And so if they find that their employees are not feeling so comfortable, there's probably a tiered approach that they could take. They could hire a police escort if they want. They could modify their hours of operation, even though they have the right to do it 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. to something different so that they could increase from 12 hours to something else, maybe 14 hours, the available times that they could deliver. And Jeff, I don't know if you want to button that up a little bit. And
yeah, I do. Delivery. Good evening, everyone. My name's Jeff Robelier. I'm the Director of Operations and Construction. The plan for deliveries is, as you say, random. The quantity of product that the store will need does not require daily delivery or even every other day. We think that it's going to be maybe once or twice a week. And what day that occurs can certainly be random. Additionally, the times can be random. And we are asking for those 12 hours of operational time, except on Sundays. But as Tom said, that's not necessarily what we will actually do. So where we transport that product from. Could be from our own facility in Worcester. It could be from another supplier. But the route that we take to get to Amherst will vary every time, and the day will vary and the times will vary. So I don't feel like it could be much more random than that. And that is in line with other security plans that we've reviewed for other facilities throughout the state.
I have a quick question.
Ms. Parks?
So could the are you saying that the deliveries could happen between 8 and 8?
Between 8 p.m. and 8 a.m.?
Between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. So the hours that the store is open, you would not have deliveries?
Correct.
No.
Okay.
So what you're saying is you might alter your hours?
Correct. But, yes. So what we're asking for is the ability, just out of a business, for a business decision, to have 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. And then if they find that nobody's coming between 8 a.m. and 11 a.m., there's probably some overhead that can be saved, and then they open from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. But again, it's going to really be dictated by the market. I don't know that there's enough demand to be from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Maybe, but I think we should let the market decide.
So you said, to follow up, you said that this plan had been discussed with the chief or with the police department. They approve the plan in terms of safety of, I mean, not just of the way it's set up, but in terms of the safety of the hours and the fact that it's not going to be, that it's only half the day, half 24 hours when you can deliver, and he's comfortable with this. Is that right?
I think his comment to Maureen in his email was, I've reviewed it and I have no problems with it. So
that was to the security system. I didn't know if that was directed to this. This aspect of the, I just don't know that. So yeah. Maureen, what was the chief's response, your question that he responded to? Was it the security system?
I asked him actually just about the project as a whole, what his thoughts were, and his response was, and I don't know if Rob has spoken to the police chief as well. Rob Mora is in attendance of this meeting and he's raising his hand. Mr. Mora, you may speak, but before Rob speaks, the chief Livingston said, I did get a chance to review the security plan and policies. And policy. I am good with them as presented. So does that, Rob, I'll unmute you. Or you unmute yourself. Let's see, unmute. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I did have a chance to talk to Chief Livingstone this afternoon, and he is satisfied with all aspects proposed for this application. He had no concerns with it moving forward.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, bear with me. Sorry.
So if I could suggest that we, unless there's any other questions about delivery, we should let the applicant finish the presentation, then we can engage in a series of questions.
Joan O'Mara has raised her hand.
Okay.
Joan.
Just another general question about traffic. I don't know about volume, as we don't know the demand at this site. Wondering if there's been any traffic understanding of the increased roadway usage, given that Route 9 on the way to work going eastbound to westbound can be pretty backed up. And I wonder if there's been any consideration around that issue.
So, Mr. Chair, if I could, maybe we finish the, because we still have some security drawings to show if the board's interested. We don't have to go through them, but they show the alarm locations, the security camera locations. And I think, you know, either Chris or Jeff can walk you through those, just so you can probably get an even better sense of, you know, why the chief said what he said. And then we can talk about traffic. We've got our traffic engineer here. And so, I mean, I can give a quick and dirty rough overview of it, or we can get into methodology and counts and all those other things. But maybe we finish up with the site plan first and then can move on to those things, but whatever the board wants.
Ms. O'Meara, I know we're going to spend significant time on parking and traffic. So let's hold that question till we discuss the traffic issues generally, because I think that's a significant issue for the, I mean, at least for me it is.
It looks like
I'm in agreement.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And Mr. Reedy, I don't need a lot of, but quickly do the security camera. I'm not as concerned about that. I've reviewed it. I think the security system and what I've been able to see on the plans is pretty good, but I'm more concerned about the randomness of the deliveries than I am the cameras and the lighting and all that kind of stuff. So I think briefly go over it and then go through the rest of your presentation.
Sure. Maureen, so we have an updated slide for the security. There was just, I mean, you could probably go through yours. If you scroll down a couple of pages, there was just a misalignment in the overlay. So I'm happy to try again to share my screen if you want me to just.
What page? What do you want me to show?
Yeah. There you go. So you can see that it just doesn't, see how some things are in the parking lot?
Yeah.
If I can try to do this with share my screen, then I've got an updated one that is accurate and then Chris can speak to it.
Go ahead. So I'll stop my share.
Can you see anything?
Yes, we see it. Okay. And all the security is inside.
Ta-da. So Chris, I don't know if you want to talk about the security briefly, or if Jeff, either one of you is fine by me.
I'm certainly happy to do it.
Go ahead.
So there's a series of sheets here that show motion. This one, for instance, is showing motion sensors. And without getting into too much detail, there are sensors at every entry door, the entry and exit door in front, the entry from the common vestibule. There's a glass break sensor on the one window into the security vestibule. There are overhead sensors. There's sensors in each of the operations rooms. So that's primarily for sound, for movement. Tom, if you can go to the next sheet. Okay, so this sheet shows the card readers on each of the doors. So there are card readers essentially on every door in the facility, with the exception of the exit door, where the customers will be leaving through. And what the system will do is it will make sure that whoever goes through that door, if they swipe their ID or their security fob, it will keep track of who went through what door at what time. So there'll be a complete record of the circulation through the space. And as I said, every door will require authorized access, and then keep a record of it. If you could go to the next sheet. Okay, so this is the security camera layout. And again, there are, well, let's see, there's fundamentally two different kinds of cameras. On the exterior, you can see the yellow rectangles. Those are what are called bullet cameras, which have a narrower focus. They're intended to focus on a specific path or a specific area. And you can see that not only are there three cameras in the delivery area to be able to cover that area completely, there are cameras on the outside, on the side walkway, so that anybody approaching on the walkway will be seen. And then all of the interior cameras, which are the cameras within the black ovals, those are either wide range overhead cameras, fisheye camera that has a 360 degree view, and there's essentially a camera that is going to record every single circulation space in the building. So that's fundamentally the kind of three layers of the different kinds of security for the space.
Okay.
So maybe with that, if you'd like, we can move on to traffic and parking. I mean, I think we've covered a lot of the oversight, operation, et cetera. We're happy to jump into that as well, but it seems like parking and traffic are on everyone's mind. So I can turn it over to Jason Adams to either I can give you the, like I said, quick and dirty, but you probably want to hear about how we got the numbers, where they came from, what they applied, what dates they were taken, et cetera. So you get a sense of traffic. And then I can start on parking, and we can talk about the shopping center on its olden lot. So I guess with that, Jason, why don't I turn it over to you?
Great. Thanks, Tom. As Tom said, we have conducted a full traffic impact study and parking utilization of this project. I'm happy to go through in as much detail as you like. I'll give you a brief overview and then can answer whatever questions might come up as a result. So we conducted both the traffic study and the parking review back in November of 2019. So pre-COVID, full traffic volumes, full utilization of the site. We focused on the weekday afternoon peak hour and the Saturday midday peak hour, the two busiest times that we would expect of the site. We conducted turning movement counts at the two site driveways, as well as at the adjacent signalized intersection with Southeast Street. And we also collected traffic volumes at the Spirit House Florence Bank driveway, just to fully understand the corridor. We forecasted the vehicle trips using data published by the Institute of Transportation Engineers. So that's data from sites around the country. I know that the marijuana industry is still pretty new here in Massachusetts, though there are many that are now open. But these are based on sites with similar characteristics as what will eventually become here in Massachusetts. So the trip generation for this site during the weekday afternoon peak hour, we would expect to see about 10 entering and 10 exiting vehicles. And during the Saturday midday peak hour, we'd expect to see about 16 entering and 16 exiting vehicles. Those vehicle trips were distributed based on existing traffic volume patterns. And then we analyzed the site driveways as well as the adjacent signalized intersection to see if there were any traffic impacts associated with the project. The project, given the relatively low trip generation, is not expected to have any noticeable impact on operations. We see the same levels of service at the signalized intersection with and without the project. We also conducted a review of the safety of the driveways. We looked at available MassDOT crash data for the existing site driveways, the Spirit House driveway, the adjacent signalized intersection, and the crash history at each of those locations is below statewide and MassDOT district averages. So that indicates that there's no existing safety deficiencies along the corridor. We also completed a review of the available site distance at the project site driveways, and that greatly exceeds what is required of based on the speeds of the roadway. So again, we feel as though the site is served by driveways that can operate in a safe and efficient manner. I can pause there if you want to talk about traffic, or I can go through into parking. I'm not sure what's best for the board.
Mr. Mayor, you had some questions about parking, or about traffic?
Thank you. I'm really more concerned about the 8 a.m. shuffle between school buses going to Fort River once school resumes, when and if that will happen, and what hour of traffic you've studied for the early morning hour in terms of westbound to eastbound on Route 9.
Sure. So this type of use, I know we just spent some time talking about hours of operation, but we wouldn't expect, based on the data available, for this use to generate very many trips in the weekday morning peak period. Given the parameters of the site and the ITE data shows that we only would expect about 5 entering and 4 exiting vehicles during the weekday morning peak hour. Very small. I mean, that's the difference between, different days of the week. I don't think you'd even notice that there were 5 additional vehicles over the course of an entire hour. So our study focused on the weekday afternoon and Saturday midday when the site would be expected to generate a larger number of trips. We don't have specific traffic volume data during the AM, but given the trip generation expected of the site, we wouldn't expect there to be any impact whatsoever.
I'm good with that. Thank you.
All right. Should we move on to parking?
Sure. So we, in addition to the traffic study that we completed, we also conducted a parking utilization study of the site. Also back in November, we counted from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. on a Thursday and from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. on a Saturday. We captured where vehicles were parking throughout the site. At the time, we looked at both Lot 1 and Lot 2, just to have a full picture of the whole area. So Lot 1, the focus point here, there are 66 available parking spaces in that what's contained within the yellow box on the screen here. During the PM peak, at 4:30 was the busiest, and we counted 26 vehicles, leaving 40 open spaces during that weekday afternoon peak. The Saturday peak, as I'm sure everyone would guess, was certainly busier. That peaked at 11:30 a.m. and we counted 56 vehicles on what is contained within the yellow block there on Lot 1, 56 vehicles at the peak at 11:30. By the time it got to 12:30, that was down below 40 vehicles. So very much a peak driven by what we would expect to be brunch traffic at Kelly's.
So Jason, can I just jump in for 1 second? So
sure.
When he says the yellow box, I just want to say yellow box extended because
sure,
this area
right.
Here,
it does have that top piece, yep.
In the yellow box, it's part of Lot 1 in his calculation.
Correct. Okay. And Tom, do you want me to speak to Lot 2 as well?
Yeah, or might just, as well.
Okay. So Lot 2, just for informational purposes, there are 41 spaces on Lot 2. During that same PM peak, there were 16 vehicles parked on Lot 2. So 25 open spaces in addition to the 40 open spaces on Lot 1. And during the Saturday peak, there were 20 vehicles parked on Lot 2. So 21 available parking spaces in addition to the 10 available parking spaces on Lot 1. Indicates that there's enough parking, but just, we wanted to just focus on Lot 1 here with our study. So what we did was we forecasted the number of vehicles that would be expected to be parked as a result of this project. That includes customers and employees based on the ITE data. We would expect that a portion of the vehicles parked on this site that might already be there would come to the site. It's considered to be a shared parking trip when you have different combinations of retail or retail and restaurant ITE data suggests that close to 30% of your parking trips may be shared between different uses, so that people come to this site, go to multiple stores, that's considered a shared parking trip. Applying that shared parking trip, we would expect the site in the afternoon to generate 5 additional parked vehicles, and during the Saturday, the ITE indicates 9 additional parked vehicles at that peak. So adding that together during the weekday afternoon and really throughout the weekday, we would expect that there would not be any type of parking issue whatsoever. Plenty of availability. On lot one alone, there are over 30 spaces that we'd expect to be available. During the Saturday, it is a little tighter. It gets up, basically lot one is at capacity when you factor in adding in the additional parked vehicles associated with this trip. But again, as I said, once you get past that brunch rush, you get to noon and 12:30, from 12:30 on, we're seeing that the site should have a maximum capacity of 70%. So from 12:30 on, there's plenty of parking available, is what our data shows. And at that peak, at 11:30, lot one full, but we're not even factoring in that lot two is available. There are parking spaces just across the aisle.
I have a question.
Mr. Langsdale? Yep.
Statistics on the parking area, does that include the probable 15 cars when this dispensary is up and running? They have claimed that they will have 15 employees.
Jason, let me respond to that.
Sure.
Where will they park?
Sure. So I think, Keith, what that is saying is there will be 15 full-time employees, but they're not all on shift at the same time. I mean, if you look at the site and the floor plan, if you've got 15 people in there, you probably don't have much area for customers to come in. But I think it was just a representation. Look at that. I think it was just a representation to the town that this is going to be job producing, and not that there are going to be 15 employees there at that time.
Okay.
And so Jason, and he can speak to it, but the ITE uses employees when they say, here is what that number is that this use will require. So his 5 on the weekday and 9 on Saturday is inclusive of employees during that hour, or the parking spaces during that hour.
Ms. Parks?
Will there be a parking lot attendant as there are for some of the other dispensaries? I'm thinking if it gets crowded in front, if people try to park at Spirit House or across the street at some of the other businesses.
Yeah, I think what Ms. Pollock's condition is pretty well developed. You know, if there is an issue, then I think, you know, we would have a conversation with the building commissioner, and if he would want the imposition of a parking attendant, then we can certainly utilize a parking attendant. You know, I think what we've seen, and Jason can probably speak to this, but I know what I've seen. So I've permitted a few of these. We started off with Rise, which was GTI in North Amherst. And I think it was at a point when there were only maybe 2 up and operational, you know, Cultivate in Leicester and then Netta in Northampton. And everybody's experience with just those 2 was pretty terrible. There was a lot of traffic. There were parking issues, et cetera. But I think what folks are seeing is that it's not a mature industry here in Massachusetts. It is getting more mature, and you're not seeing the type of lines that you saw at the beginning. I mean, Rise had an additional parking lot where it was just never used. So they actually ended up returning it back to its natural vegetative state. And they made that decision based upon actual live data that they didn't need that additional parking. So, you know, I think as this goes on, we're starting to learn more, and it's lost some of the shininess and the novelty. But I think in those circumstances, when they're experiencing higher than normal volume, then certainly we have a good relationship with the police department. Stan certainly does. Jeff does. You know, we're having a conversation with them, or if we get a call and there's an issue, we're happy to have that conversation about what can we do to mitigate the issues that are being caused if we're the cause of them. So kind of a long-winded answer, but yes, sure. Parking attendants, fine, if and as necessary.
I just know that it's very busy there. I often use those businesses and almost always the front spaces are taken. And so I'm thinking, you know, if everyone's going to the side spaces, that's great. But if everyone's going to those front spaces again, I'm just concerned that people will start going over to Spirit House rather than parking along the side.
Right. And it's probably one of those things where you kind of let nature take its course a little bit, because I know that, you know, RC is going to want to be, and the landlord will make sure that they'll be a good neighbor to these other retail tenants. And if all of a sudden you've got all of RC's folks parking here in Summerlin Floors or Talon Furniture, right, or Mom's, you know, all of those, right, things, you know, they're too close to do that. So I think if there is an issue, it's just a conversation to be had, and then probably a parking attendant in place to shepherd folks, you know, where there's openings.
Okay.
Mr. Reedy, what's the occupancy limit in that building? How many retail customers can you have in there at a time?
In the RC retail space?
Yeah.
I'll turn to Chris on the spot. What do you think?
Chris, you're muted.
I don't remember what the number is, oh, Tom.
You were sorry. I was asking Chris Farley. Oh. I don't want to put on the spot. I thought the architect would know. If you know, that would be even better. But
Chris, are you there?
I am. I'm sorry. I'm having trouble with the shared screen. But can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay. I believe, and bear with me here, I'm just going through my own drawings. I believe we have those numbers on
You want me to share my floor plan?
Well, I seem to be having, yes, please, sheet A1.
Tom can do it.
A1.
Well, you know what? That shows the square footage calculations. I believe that the number of customers that can be accommodated inside the building is somewhere between 25 and 30, including one person at each of the five point of sale stations. And so that's between the security vestibule, the queuing space, and the point of sale stations.
25 or 30 people in a 300 plus employees in a 397 foot building, square foot building. That seems, well, that's, we should check that. That seems pretty dense.
That's maximum occupancy. And that would be if the space was completely full. I also think the intention is that we do have,
go ahead, Chris. I'm sorry.
I was going to say that there is quite a good amount of exterior queuing space. I believe the way the facility is intended to be managed and operated is that they will only a Red Cardinal will be letting in a certain number of people. Certainly the ideal is to have anyone who's waiting be inside the building. But if there's any concern about overcrowding, there is an exterior queue that's quite convenient that would not interrupt the business of any of the other businesses in the building. It's a queue that would go down the side of the building underneath that exterior awning.
Well, maybe Jeff, maybe you want to talk about transaction time, because, you know, even though I think what Chris is, Mr. Farley, saying is that why he was giving you data relative to the building code and the number of people at maximum you could have in there, which I think is good to know. But I think then there's the practical reality of what is the market going to dictate? And then also operationally, what is RC retail going to want? And I don't know, I mean, do they want 25 to 35, 30 there? Probably, but I just don't see that as happening at any one point, just based on the market. I mean, frankly, there's the Heirloom Collective right down the street in Hadley. You're gonna have pick a number on University.
All right, just a second, Keith.
Three have been approved, and you've got Rise Up in North Amherst. So, you know, it's, and Jeff, maybe you can talk about the products that you're selling, but, you know, I like to use the analogy of this is, it's kind of like a package store where, yes, you can buy RC retail product, but you can also buy, you know, Howells, or you can buy products that have been manufactured, processed elsewhere, and flour that has been grown elsewhere. And you can probably also get those same things at the Heirloom Collective or at Rise. And so, you know, to a certain extent, it's, you know, we're getting away from that Cultivate and Netta, where they're the only shows in town, or even for a beer analogy, Treehouse Brewing, which they don't sell their brewed beer anywhere but at their location. And so folks will go there. But Jeff, I don't know if you want to talk about operationally any transaction times or products.
Yes. we've done a lot of research on dispensaries operating currently in Massachusetts, and the average transaction time is about 10 minutes. So if you take Jason's traffic study and assume you're going to get 10 people per hour, excuse me, maybe there's two people in the car, you're never going to see more than 10 people in the store. And as Tom is talking about, there's lots of competition now. And what we're finding is that pent-up demand for these marijuana products is not as pent-up as it was when the stores first started opening. There's lots of places people can go to buy these products. So we don't see overcrowding in the store as an issue at all, but we also do have that outside queue on the side of the building. And that's pretty much how we look at it.
Mr. Langsdale?
Yeah, okay. I hear what Mr. Reedy is saying, but I think for us as the ZBA, we have to look at this and say, well, yeah, maybe you're not going to have more than 10 or 12 people at a time, but we have to look at it and say, what if there are 35 or 40 or 50 people? Where does that queue go? Does it go down the east side of the building? Who regulates it? You have the security vestibule, you have the entrance, and then the people have to check in at the security station right there. So right there, there's a bottleneck. If you've got several people waiting just outside, also you have an ATM machine right there, which means if anybody wants to use it, now maybe you have three or four or five people jammed up there. One of the things I wanted to say was perhaps you could move the ATM machine over by the door that goes into the queue area so that, so that it's not right. You have, it looks to me like you have a bottleneck of security, door, and ATM. So that's one thing to consider. I think it's important. You have made, given that people go through the door into the queue area, you have a serpentine system so that if there are 20 people, you know, I mean, first of all, you've got how many people you've got five people on the point of sale stations. You've got the security, you've got operations person. I don't know how many other people you have, but you have a queue that can accommodate, I don't know, 10, 12 people. And then you've got the five. So there's the capacity for a lot of people. So I think it's incumbent upon the ZBA to look at this and say, okay, let's go with the, let's say, in quotes, worst case scenario, best case for you, because you've got a lot of people coming in. How is that handled? And how are you prepared to handle that? That's what our question is, I think. And I think it's one that you have, we have to address and know specifics for.
Well, let me try to give you the specifics. Is it at that security vestibule will be a security agent who is there to check IDs and to make sure people are sober who are coming in. But they're also there to control the flow of people into the facility. And as you say, we don't want people, you know, like a Marine Corps chow line right up against each other in that queue. So the answer is that our staff will control the flow into the facility. So if the line is backed up and we do get fortunate enough to have that kind of a crowd, then the security agent will direct them to the outside and keep them in the queue. If you also, if we have that even a bigger crowd than the queue can handle, if you look at our draft security plan that we submitted, our intention is, if we have extreme crowds, is to coordinate with the police department for situational advice on how to deal with it. And we will have parking lot attendants if the masses show up. And if we can't accommodate them in the store and on the outdoor queue, the parking lot attendants will direct them to the exit of the shopping center and tell them to come back later. So, but we, as you say, we don't want a mob in the store, and our employees and our staff in the store will control that. And if we have to, we'll bring in parking lot attendants to control the outside in conjunction with the police department. And I do want to add that we are we have a different business in Connecticut. We're a associate company, is a real estate development company. We have people, hourly people who work on our staffs. So if we had a problem with traffic control, we could have people here in 90 minutes to take care of it. And we're very sensitive to it. And if the police department or anyone was to call us and say, you know, you have this problem, we are ready to respond to it because we do want to be a good neighbor.
Excuse me, you have people in Connecticut who could come in, but they could be here in 90 minutes?
Yes.
That's given traffic. Have you ever gone up 91? I mean, I find that inadequate.
Well, let me say this. In the interim, between the time I could get people there, because they'd be there for a few days if the traffic's going to be that bad, I would pay the chief and the police department for off-duty officers to control it immediately, and then bring in our own staff as we could get them there.
Okay, then if you have people backed up beyond outside of the security vestibule, and this happens, you don't have parking lot attendants I'm assuming you're not going to have them on all the time anyway. What tells them to line up along the east wall instead of hanging out where the deliveries truck goes?
The security agent and the store manager.
You have one security agent in the security place. How does that one person regulate what happens outside the building?
No, there is a person in the security booth. That person is there. There is a store manager. There are store staff. And so they will control the people. And if people are hanging around out front waiting to get in the store, the security agent or the store manager will go outside and direct them as where to go. So that's how you control people, is you have
The security agent can't leave the booth. So it can't be the security agent. That's what I'm asking. Who then is it who would control that?
The security agent can certainly leave the booth. He can go outside because people can't get into the store.
The security agent can leave the booth?
Yes.
Then there's no security.
I don't know how to explain it to you better than Jeff.
Mr. Robler, over here, are you saying that you could lock the door so that nobody could get in, and then the security agent could go out and control the crowd, and then the security agent would come back in and then open the door again so people could come in? Is that what you're saying?
That's correct. If you look at this plan that's in front of us, if you look at the door to the right of the security vestibule, that's a controlled locked door. No one can go through that door into the facility unless the security agent in the booth buzzes the door open. So on the one hand, you could have the security agent go out. There could be people in the vestibule. You could have the security agent go out, direct people to the proper queue, or to go leave and come back at a later time, and then go back to his booth and continue to process people into the facility. In addition to that, the store manager can go outside. The store manager is not going to be tending the counter. The store manager is going to be managing the whole store. The store manager can go out on his or her authority and tell people where to queue up. It'd be the same thing anybody does when they have a store. The people running the store control the crowd.
So it seems, Mr. Langsdale, do you have another question? If not, I had a comment.
No, go ahead.
Yep. It seems to me that we need a couple of things. We need to know total number of people, the occupancy limits on this square foot of retail space, which I think is 397 square feet. There's a limit in, and I don't know what it is, and I don't think anybody here knows what it is, the number of occupants you can have in this place, which includes security, clerks, store managers, all that. So that number we need. We work back from that. Okay, we can get that. And then we can work back from that and say, well, how many cars does that involve in terms of customers? We can compare that to Mr. Adams' estimates on how many people are likely to come. We can multiply that by a factor to get to deal with Mr. Langsdale's and my concerns, and we can have a better sense of how likely it is we're going to have queuing up outside. But I think we have to start with some numbers, which is occupancy, staff, and then what that means in terms of people that can be in the store.
Mr. Chair, there are two people raising their hand.
Who's that?
Ms. O'Mara and Mr. Rosenberg.
Okay, Ms. O'Mara.
I did not mean to raise my hand, sorry.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Rosenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate the concern and the reflection on this important point. I just wanted to add, I hope we have this problem, and if we had this problem, I'm sure we would come up with a permanent ongoing solution with the town, with the police, that everybody would be satisfied with. But I certainly understand that before you issue any final decision on this, that these questions and the way you just framed it are totally appropriate. I just wanted to add one other thing. I live 5 minutes from the site, and I will be a resident of the community, and I'm part of the team. So if this situation were to arise, I would hope that the manager would call all hands on deck, and I'd be the closest hand 5 minutes away, presumably most times and in most situations. But I realize you're looking for a systemic response and answer, and I'm sure we will come up with the appropriate information an appropriate solution, but I just wanted to add the fact that I'm not 90 minutes away, I'm actually 5 minutes away, and I'd be there in a flash. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you. So any further questions from ZBA members or town staff? Okay, let's continue the presentation, Mr. Reedy, and then we'll have some questions.
Sure.
What else do we have to go through?
So I think probably what I'll do is just touch on parking. a little bit just relative to the site. So I think what Jason talked about is more of justification for our request for a parking waiver. So on the sites combined, so lot one and lot two, there are 107 parking spaces. Based upon the uses on lot one and lot two combined, they need 112 parking spaces. So there was back in 1998 a parking waiver granted, and that parking waiver was effectively renewed most recently at the end of April for both of the sites. It looks like lot one requires 76 spaces and they have 66 spaces. And this is pre-marijuana use. And then post-marijuana use, so assuming that it gets approved, we're talking about 83 spaces being required. So that's required in accordance with the strict interpretation, strict language of the bylaw. So when we take section 7, we look through and we say, here's a square footage, here's a number of seats in Kelly's, et cetera. Those are the numbers we come up with. And then I think we have the actual data. And I mean, this photograph, I didn't pick it. It came up through GIS. But I think it's a pretty accurate portrayal of what you're going to find on that site on most days. It sounds like the concerning time, if I could be so brash as to say concerning, is that hour on Saturdays from 11:30 to 12:30. And outside of that, there seems to be sufficient parking spaces on lot one. You know, we would suggest that if it pleased the board, we could get something in writing from the landowner that there would be some parking available on lot two. I mean, I think Jason said there are 21 spaces available on lot two at that Saturday peak time. And while we do strictly, we comply if we were to get the waiver, it probably not bad form to have something as a sort of release valve to allow those vehicles from the shopping center, right? So I think this is the only marijuana establishment that is going to, hopefully, exist within a shopping center and not in a standalone building. And so, as Jason talked about with the shared parking, it's very likely that somebody will park, walk into Summerlin, realize there's a marijuana establishment, and maybe go and check it out. Or
so, Mr. Reedy, have you talked to the owner, the same owner,
yes,
about lot two, about getting the 20, the difference of 20 spaces and having a leased parking arrangement?
I don't think there'd be an issue to do that.
Well, so there may be something that we could consider, but right now there's 66 available spots and the code calls for 86 and you're asking for a waiver to drop you down to what?
So we have 66, the zoning bylaw requires 83 and we're looking 83? For, I guess it's an extension of the parking waiver or an amendment of the existing parking waiver to allow us to stick with the 66.
And stay with 66.
Part of this, Mr. Chair, is as good as well as I can read the board through Zoom, it sounds like we're going to be coming back at some point.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wonder if we could just, because we're about done with our presentation, if we could just talk about any of the other issues that the board may have, right? So that, you know, we are on a time schedule with the Cannabis Control Commission as well. And so we just want to make sure that, you know, ideally the next meeting is our last meeting. So whatever information you'd request, we're happy to provide it.
A good piece of information. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, Ms. O'Mara has raised her hand.
All right. Ms. O'Mara.
Oh, sorry.
Oh.
I don't mean to raise my hand, but I'll take the opportunity. So in conclusions from town staff, there were some questions. Should we address those now or wait for the next meeting?
Well, you know, I have some questions of that I do want to get to. And we should.
So I'll defer to you, Steve, at this point.
Yeah. Why don't we do this? Because I am I am concerned about the time. We have another, we have two other items we want to get to.
I agree.
And I don't want to, we've spent 2 hours here. So I want to be able to go through my concerns quickly and then go through the rest of the, and let other members state their concerns. Perhaps we need a good chance for them. Okay, then let's do that. So let me run through my concerns and then we can get other people a second. Let me just find it. I've written a lot down tonight. Okay, I have my threshold question is this, Mr. Levy. Part of the premises you have that you lease is within the 300-foot buffer from a residence. And you have, it's a very convoluted way in which you've brought up the, you've designed the space. And so I'm wondering, number one, what is in operations in the retail space, what is going to be done in operations? And where is the secure safe or secure holding area for the marijuana products that's required under state law?
Chris or Jeff, do you want to answer that?
Yes, the vault is in the operations room. I believe it's 105. It's the one with the angle adjacent to the queue. We labeled it so it was operations and not the vault.
Yep.
This becomes public information. We're trying to keep it a secret. It's also, you'll notice it's located on the interior of the building, not near an outside wall for security.
Right. Okay. And what's done up, what's 108? 106 is the one you were just talking about. 108 is going to be what?
And 108 is a place where...
this is 105. That's what he was, I think he
was 105 was talking, yeah, that's where he was talking
106
about.
106 is over here. 106.
Yep.
Okay, 106 is a place for employees to put product in the baskets to bring them out to the point of sale. It's all a place for them to, put their lunch in those little lockers. Excuse me. And then the operations 105A is the IT closet where the our internet server and our security cameras will be run back to that area.
Okay. There's a swipe pad on between the shared space and the lease space. Is that right? That door has a swipe pad to it. So
here, yes. Have to,
okay. What is contemplate? You have a conference room, shared utility, shared storage in the common area. What is contemplated the use of that?
For our use, frankly, we don't see much use of it. Excuse me, except for the bathroom. We had to lease that space as part of the deal. So we're just making it convenient and sharing it with the tenant who may or may not lease the other vacant space. But the primary use of it is if you see shared utilities, that's where the electric meters will be and so on. Who knows what the other space is, but the primary reason is for the bathroom.
And in the common vestibule, there's a new metal door. That's where the employee entrance for Red Cardinal would be?
That's what we anticipate, yes.
Employee entrance, and that would have some kind of a safety feature to it as well, a swipe pad?
Yeah, they would have a swipe pad to that, and as would the future tenant for the space to the right, and then they would have a separate security swipe to get into the retail area.
So the threshold question really is this space, the lease, the shared space has three, certainly two, and just for a tiny part, violates three different buffers. And it seems to me that I need an answer from you as to why this is actually different than the other marijuana use. You can't operate your marijuana shop without a bathroom. You can't operate your marijuana shop with, and you can't do the training. I'm assuming you're going to do the training and other kinds of employee requirements that are required under state law in your shared conference room. You got to have your employees come in. You can't do that. You can't conduct your marijuana business without your employees and your employee come in through the common vestibule. And it seems an artificial and contorted segregation of function. Artificial segregation of function between marijuana use and non-marijuana use there, as well as outside, where you'll have people lined up along this area waiting to get along the wall, waiting to get in if it's busy, and they will be within the buffer. And so when I look at this, I wonder if we're really trying to squeeze the most out of the space. And so, and I don't know what the legal definition of marijuana use is, but I looked at the state regulations, 500, whatever it was, it's 122 pages, but I looked at it like it's 500.0015, I think. And they talk about all the different operations that go on and all the uses. And it includes a bunch of things that have to be done in the shared space. So talk to me about, respond to my concern about that. And if you can't do it now, we can wait till next week when we can hear more about it then, if you have to give it some thought, I understand.
No, I if I could. So I think the marijuana use is where the transaction occurs. I mean, I think it's as simple as that. And that transaction okay. is going
and
to
you get
occur.
And where do you get that from? Is that what the law says?
Logically. Otherwise, where do you draw the line? So when I leave my house to go to a marijuana establishment, am I?
Well, you don't own the marijuana establishment. You don't own the marijuana establishment in that case, but.
You know what I mean? Like where does it end? And so I think, you know, I draw a lot of analogies between this and liquor licenses, because they're somewhat similar. If you look at the title of the act, it is, you know, an act to regulate marijuana, like it's the regulation and taxation of marijuana, which is really dealt mm-hmm. with similarly to alcohol. And alcohol have licensed premises. And so ultimately, this will be a licensed premises. And if, let's say, Spirit House has a great deal or has some treehouse beer and folks line up outside, you know, is that use, and granted Spirit House might be a little bit of a different scenario because it's a single building on a single lot, but that licensed premise is, according to the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission, just that interior space where that transaction happens. It's not the parking lot, it's not the outside space, it's not people walking from their cars, even if they're taking the product from inside Spirit House back to their cars, or they're waiting outside of Spirit House to have a transaction, it's where that transaction happens. And so using that as an analog, the use is where the marijuana transaction happens.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm not sold on that yet, Mr. Reedy, but I understand your argument. And I think it'd be helpful if there is some guidance from the Cannabis Commission, or there's some guidance from legislative history in the state law about what the use is, because that's really what we're looking at here. And I don't want to set a precedent of I'm concerned of setting a precedent of allowing businesses within buffer areas where they're not supposed to be by a creative, and I don't mean this in a negative sense, but an unclear, to my view, interpretation of the law, and in this case of the regulations. So let's perhaps some further work on that would be helpful for me for next time we visit, the next meeting we have. Another question I had, and we talked about opening date, we talked about police and the relationship there. One of the questions I had, would you be interested in doing the same thing that other marijuana shops have done or RMDs have done, which is kind of turn over to the chief of police their judgment for the first 6 months of whether they need to have an officer or a traffic monitor out in there, and instead of saying, well, we'll certainly do it on our own if we think it's necessary. Other places have said, we'll leave it up to the police department's judgment if we need to have a police presence or we need to have other kind of parking monitors. Would that be something you would consider?
Yeah, I don't see what, I mean, I think if from what Jeff had said, that's part of our plan. And I think I can tell you what Chief Livingstone would say, and it's not going to be an issue. I mean, I think the board needs to understand that this is it's just a retail use. It's similar to other retail uses.
But we've also had this, we had just retail use, and we had that same agreement with the lessee, is that they turned it over to the, in effect, the judgment of the police department is whether they needed to have additional personnel, policemen there, or they needed to have additional personnel.
Yeah, I mean, that.
Okay.
I don't see any issue, but I'm just telling you what the result's going to be. I don't mean to be curt or short, but I just think the shine has worn off on this.
There's a sign, and one of your signs will be, you have two signs on the building, you have a third sign on lot two. Is that right? No?
I don't know that there's
I thought there was a
sign on lot two.
Was there a sign? And go to your signage plan.
Yeah, it's all on the building
it's
wall.
It's only two signs? Yeah.
It's
so the sign right here, the RC, and let me zoom in so you can see it.
So maybe that's a light at the corner of on lot two. Maybe that's a light at the corner of Route 9 and where lot two meets Route 9. It's so hard to read these things on Zoom.
It was my interpretation that the circle was one sign. If you go back.
Yes.
No, the corner, so that little circle with the tabs is a street light, a pole light.
Street light. Okay. All right.
There's no sign.
Those are my fundamental questions. And I'd like to let other ZBA members ask questions now.
I think Joan raised her hand, but I might have made that up.
I have one
question, Keith,
which I don't need
Mr. Langsdale.
Now you can, you know, next time. you're stating that you're going to put in 4 18-foot pole lights along the parking areas. Are those to be, what are their hours of operation?
Good question. I don't know the answer to that. I will get you that answer. I think because there's one pole light right here.
Yeah.
Where my mouse is. Another one here. Another one here.
And what? Yeah.
How about that? And then that fourth one right there. Does the board have a preference?
Well, personally, I don't think they should be on all night, but
photo sensors would be the best use for those. Very simple.
Yeah.
Expensive, and it will only go on when the light goes to a certain dimness, and then it'll go off with a timer.
I don't see an issue with that. I mean, if this, because I think this is more for the site itself, you know, because this use is going to, let's say it's open till 8 o'clock. You know, it's 8:11 right now and the light might just be coming on, but the place is already closed. So there's going to, you know, come June 21st. And then obviously the winter time's a little bit different, but I think these are, you know, illuminating this traveled way, which I think just is good form for those residents getting back to that mixed use piece. So maybe they come on at dusk or near dusk and go off by 11 p.m. or something like that. You know, we'll try to be sensitive to the residents who might be using it to get back to their apartments.
But one of the reasons I ask is because there's nothing there now, correct? Right. And you're adding these for your business. So I think there should be some regulation in terms of how long they're on, you know.
I think this is something that Paul Shumway, who's a landowner, would probably want regardless, because the only light is where my mouse is right now.
Yeah.
On Spirit House, and it's a pole light and it's shining it's like a floodlight, just shining into here. So there's nothing here. There's nothing in here. I think it's just good practice to have something there because folks, you know, the only way to get back here is for folks to travel this way. Mm-hmm. So, you know, yes, they're part of this proposal, but I just want to be, you know, honest about, I think they should go there regardless, and there shouldn't necessarily be a nexus between those lights' existence and the hours of operation, et cetera, or existence of the
marijuana. Yeah, and if you could have a discussion with him, with the owner, to see if he wants them on a certain time, or just so that you're in agreement with that, that's all.
No, not a problem at all. I'll have a conversation with him.
Any other questions from regular members or associate members?
I have one.
Yes, Ms. Parks.
So when we come back, would it be possible to have some pictures of what the rolling doors would look like? Because I did see that there's a small graphic on one of the pages. But if we could just see a picture of it and see that it's ventilated, I think I would feel more comfortable to understand, you know, exactly what it is. Yeah, I saw that. If you had some kind of photograph that what that is,
you photograph so you can see what they look like. They're simple enough to get.
Okay.
And any other questions or comments from members of the board? Well, before we suspend the hearing, I'd like to open it up to, this is the time to open it up to public comment if there is any. Maureen, do we have any members of the public that are listening in and that want to comment or that have indicated?
If any members of the public would like to speak about this special permit application, click on the button to raise your hand and then we'll call on you.
So I just wanted to point out, this is Chris, that Joan O'Meara's hand is raised.
Joe, is it really?
I don't mean to raise it.
I've heard that once or twice. anyone else? It looks like no one is raising their hand.
Okay, so it's, I think the consensus of the board and would be to suspend the hearing where we are here, to come back, set the next date that's available, Maureen, to continue this. We'll continue with presentations from the applicant, questions from the board and from the public, and then we'll conduct that and we'll move into the public meeting area. But we have to, I don't wanna close out the public hearing yet, I wanna leave it open.
Sure, okay. Are folks available for July 9th as a possible continued public hearing date? And if so, does 6 o'clock work, or would 6:30 for some people be better?
Let me just look at my calendar. I think that would work. July 9th, you said?
Correct. Ms. O'Meara, do you have any comments about the
6:30
time?
6:30 would be better for me. 6:30.
Okay. Other members, does 6:30 on Thursday, July 9th? Let's verify that I'm saying the right date.
I have a question.
Go on.
Yes, Mr. Landale.
Will this be the only thing we address on that night?
Well,
we don't have any. You don't have anything else scheduled for that night yet, do you, Maureen?
I do not. I do not. I mean,
I'm not sure if we're going to be able to finish this, the next item on the agenda, Mr. Langsdale. So I just don't know. So there may be the next item.
Well, then we have that tradition now of 6 p.m. And if we're going to have more than one, I don't know, 6:30, are we then talking about changing the time for every time we do this? It's been 6 o'clock.
Keith, I'll speak to that. Keith?
Yeah.
I have to work until 6 p.m. with the virus going on at the hospital, so that's obligation.
Let's make it 6:30.
Yeah,
all right, thank you, and hopefully it will end soon.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I hope it does.
Thank you.
Maureen, there's nothing sooner than that?
July 2nd, and we have July 25th. We're reserving for a different project.
June 25th?
Yes.
June 25th, yeah.
Sorry, I probably said July, sorry. June 25th, we are reserving for
a occupancy one.
Yes.
Okay. It looks like that's as soon as we can do it. So let's look for that date. So I move that we continue the hearing until July, what's the date again? July 9th? July 9th at 6:30 p.m. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? If there's no discussion, all in favor say aye. Well, we have a roll call vote. Don't we need roll call?
Yeah, you have to do a roll call.
All right. Chairman votes aye. Ms. O'Meara?
Aye.
Ms. Parks?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
And Mr. Maxfield?
Aye.
Motion passes. It's unanimous.
Thank you. Maureen, can I just get a list of who the members are who were voting just at some point?
Oh, yeah. I'll email you tomorrow.
Great. Thank you.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Good seeing you. Thank you for all your time,
Mr. Reed.
Stay healthy. Yep. We'll see you soon.
Yep. Okay.
Mr. Chair, I just wanted to let you know that Attorney Witten has now joined us.
Okay. So Mr. Witten can help us with rules and regulations. We have one other item that we need to deal with first, which is the other item on the agenda, correct? Which is ZBA 2020-38, or ZBA, ZBA 2020-37, Fetterman Family Limited Partnership request to provide a special permit to allow increase in the number of residential units or converted dwelling from 1 to 2 under sections 3.324 and 10.38 located at 152 Logtown Road, map 18D, parcel 303, neighborhood residential RN district. Sitting on this panel will be myself, Mr. O'Meara, Ms. Parks, Mr. Langsdale, and Mr. Maxfield. We had a site visit at 152 Logtown Road on Monday. Let me get to my notes. We viewed the property and walked around the property. We had the representative there describe the work to be done, including the work on the deck. We've asked questions about the second exit in the basement off to the off the side, not in the backyard, but the side yard. We asked questions about the slope of the sidewalk and whether there'd be a need for a retaining wall. We asked questions about whether there was a Conservation Commission meeting and decision on this. We had questions about the placement of the deck and its size. We had questions about new lighting and if they would be downcast and dark sky compliant. We went to the parking spaces, measured them. We had questions about whether there was an on-site manager. And those were the ones that I had listed as questions. I don't know if anybody else who attended the site visit had other questions that were raised. What we have in terms of documents from the applicant, we have received a cover letter, a waiver request for submission requirements. We've received a parking plan, a special permit application, a management plan, project summary, residential lease agreement, a complaint response plan, proposed findings from the applicant, a building permit plan, existing floor plans, three of the existing floor plans, a set of photographs of the interior because we did not view the interior on our site visit, project application report, and comments received from the electrical inspector dated May 27th, 2020. I think that's all we've gotten in terms of documents that for the record. I think that's right, isn't it, Maureen?
Yes.
Okay. So I'd like to turn this over to the applicant to run through what you want to do and describe it as best you can. And then we'll have questions from the board members. Oh, Mr. Burson, you're muted and we can't hear you.
There we go. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Wonderful. I'm using one of those podcast microphones. So please let me know if it doesn't work well. It's a kind of a new setup for me. I'm borrowing it. So good evening. My name is David Burson. I'm an attorney from Bacon Wilson. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Fetterman Family Limited Partnership. They own 152 Logtown Road. Specifically, with me, I believe tonight is Elsie Fetterman, likely on the panel, or not the panel, but in the audience, who is the general partner long-term resident of Amherst and the resident of the property next door, 148 Logtown Road, for a number of years now. Additionally, Josh Kenny, I believe, is also here from Kenny Construction. He is the contractor who has prepared the plans, and he should be here as well to kind of walk through what's being proposed here and here to answer some more of those technical questions that the board had relative to what's being proposed. Additionally, I believe Rick McGinn is also here as well. He is the property manager. He is not on site, and I will touch upon that a little bit in my application. But one thing I did want to address right off the bat before I kind of jump into it is just to clarify one thing. There was the comment about the tenant notification. So just to clarify, because I don't think I was very clear in my response to Maureen today, the tenants were all notified by Ms. Fetterman. The notification forms were personally delivered to them. I just didn't have an opportunity to notarize an affidavit with Ms. Fetterman prior to today's meeting. So I can have that dropped off at the town tomorrow morning. The affidavit stating that it was done, but the tenant notification forms actually were absolutely done. So I just wanted to clarify that point. And I will be in Amherst tomorrow, so I'll provide the updated affidavit for the board. Additionally, one thing that came out of the site visit were some requests that some changes be made to the submitted site plan, specifically relative to showing the parking area on that site plan with the actual dimensions of it, as well as showing the current lot coverage and proposed lot coverage. I have reached out to Mr. Iser, and I believe he will have those updated for us. I just didn't have them in time for tonight's meeting, unfortunately. So we're here tonight very simply to convert, or we're hoping to get approval to convert a single family home into a converted two family home in accordance with section 3.324 of the Amherst zoning bylaw. This property has been a tenant rental, or has been a student rental for a number of years now, primarily because of its location. It's located directly off of, on the corner, right off of Route 9, heavily trafficked way. I just do like to note that because it is one of the sections or criteria that's actually highlighted in the converted dwelling statute or standard of the bylaw. Is relative to being close to these traveled ways and where it's appropriately located. And we feel that this location is very appropriate considering it's not only that close to Route 9, but it's also within walking distance of a bus stop on Route 9. So it's a very attractive property for this type of conversion. And in addition to that, there have been issues, full disclosure, there have been issues in the past relative to building issues and whatnot. In fact, what prompted this was discovering that when the property was built back in the 80s, the basement window was about an inch or two narrow to be considered a legal egress. And looking at changing that was kind of the prompt to really modify things and do it the correct way with this property. Primarily because Ms. Fetterman herself is an elderly resident of Amherst. She's in her 90s. And she really is looking to move a lot of the property management responsibilities off of her own shoulders. So for a number of years now, Rick McGinn, who is a property manager who manages a number of properties in the area, not necessarily Amherst, but in the area. And he's always assisted Ms. Fetterman when it comes to handling the management of this property. We understand that as part of this process, he understands that he's going to be coming on board as a more active property manager as the primary contact for complaints and the like. That being said, the bylaws do have a requirement relative to a resident on-site manager for converted dwellings. We actually have already spoken with one potential tenant. You may have noticed him. He was actually hanging around the day of the site visit while you guys were visiting. So we have discussed with a potential tenant taking on this role, and that is our intent, and we expect that there would be a condition of the permit that one of the tenants at all times be considered or agree to being the resident agent or resident manager for the property. And what we envision for that role because we do want Rick McGinn as the property manager to be the number one contact, both for the town as well as the residents and the tenants. So we really envisioned this resident manager as being an on-site individual for getting a hold of Rick in case somebody else can't. So all the other residents will have this other resident manager's contact. The neighbors would be provided with this contact. So if there was a problem, there's somebody on site who can get a hold of Rick if for some other reason we can't get a hold of him. Because they're already in place, set schedules with respect to trash pickup, landscape maintenance, the snow plowing for the property, all of these things already have contracted services for. So Rick McGinn will make sure that those contracts stay in place and will be the primary contact if there are complaints for the property. So we are planning on meeting the resident manager requirement of the bylaw. We just didn't highlight it or outright say who it would be in the application because, quite frankly, whether or not we even have this tenant, this proposed tenant who's agreed to be the resident manager in site will depend on whether or not we actually have a viable project here. That being said, there were some additional, comments and that the building department, as well as I believe the board had technically related to this, the plans. So I'm going to turn it over to Josh Kenny so he can kind of talk through that and answer some of those questions. But I will answer some of the questions just very quickly that were immediately addressed. With respect to downcast lighting, the expectation is that there would be two new lights, at least one at the new egress and then one of the deck. Additionally, those will absolutely be downcast. And we would certainly be comfortable with the condition that we provide the fixture cut sheet for those once we've actually selected which lights will go where. Additionally, with respect to the Conservation Commission, we did go through the process already and we did receive a decision, although we don't have the physical decision yet in hand. So additionally, we understand that a condition relative to approvals of the Conservation Commission would absolutely be, required as part of this type of project. So with that being said, I'd like to turn it over to Josh Kenny if he's on the line. And I am going to mute myself unless you had other specific questions for me.
All right. How would you like to go about this? Would you like to ask me questions or would you like me to just go over?
Well, can you briefly go through the couple of points that you were going to, that David asked you to go through, Mr. Burson asked you to go through, and then if there are any questions, we can ask them directly.
Okay. The lighting and those questions, or?
Sorry, Josh, why don't you just go through a general walkthrough of what the current property looks like with the existing plan, and then kind of go through
and how you plan
where the current
size. Yeah, I think would be helpful for the members is for you to go through the suggested changes that you're going to make in exterior and interior.
Particularly where the board didn't get a chance to actually go inside the property.
Yep.
Absolutely. So inside the...
I'm just going to interrupt you. Do you want to share your screen and illustrate those changes while you're talking?
So I am at home and I may be able to do that.
I can pull it up on mine.
I was going to say, I have it. I can share my screen if we need to.
Maureen, why don't you share your screen for the existing and the proposed changes?
Okay. Hold on. Give me a minute. Building plan, floor plan. All right. So I'm going to pull up the floor plan. All right.
Yes, perfect.
Bear with me for 1 second. Okay. Does everyone see this?
Yep.
Okay. I'll zoom in. This is the existing floor plan for the basement.
Okay. So in the basement, there's going to be a couple of changes. So where the stairs go up right now in the center, the stairs are going to go away because there'll be no access from upstairs to downstairs anymore. And that hallway will lead to a door that goes outside as a common egress.
Okay, I can go to the next page. So this is the proposed basement.
So yeah, there's a hallway in the middle there. There's a new hallway heading out the north side. I think that's the north Sure. That'll lead to the second egress, and there'll be a walkway outside that door. Bedroom on the rear of the house gets split into two bedrooms. We're adding a kitchen in the living room area, and that's about it downstairs. There'll be a new window also in bedroom six. There's an additional window getting cut in to that exterior wall.
Is this the backyard?
The backyard is at the top of the screen.
This is the backyard. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, that makes sense. This is the door. This was, yep. Okay, yep.
I think that's it for all the changes down there. The first floor is less. The living room, the existing living room on the first floor, will become a bedroom. There'll be a hallway from the front door, which is at the bottom of the screen. So that hallway will lead into the kitchen. The stairway will go where the refrigerator is, will go, and that'll become the living room. And that's the only changes upstairs. Oh, I'm sorry. There'll be a new deck on the back for a second egress out of the living room with a stairway to the driveway.
I hate to interrupt, but Maureen, can I ask that you mute yourself when you're not talking? There's just a bad background noise coming from your microphone.
I think that's about it for changes upstairs. The sliding glass door will, be the second egress to the new deck. I think that's all the changes there. Outside, which I think if you go down one more sheet, we can have some elevations. So the north elevation has no changes except for the deck entrance. This would lead to the parking area. The south elevation is the new egress door at the end of the hallway. There may be a retaining wall here, depending on how the grades work out. And that walkway will be fairly level going to the backyard. And the east elevation, you can see the new deck there, the new sliding glass door exit from the living room on the first floor, the new egress directly under that for the basement, and the new window next to it. The two sliding glass doors in the basement level are existing. I guess I'll open up to questions.
Can you describe the parking lot or the parking situation?
When we were out there, you may recall we did pull out the tape measure. So we are confident, we know for a fact that there are at least the four spaces required under the zoning bylaw for the two dwelling units proposed. That is planned, or the request that we've made to Mr. Iser is that he include the dimensions of that parking area as well as the paved area on the a new site plan, so that we can actually just show you the actual exact four spaces that are required. Our intent is for that area to be the primary parking for that. It makes a lot of sense. There's already an existing vegetative buffer that was installed 2 years ago when Ms. Fetterman did some work on 148. So there's already a buffer of vegetation to the north between the two parking areas. So it makes a lot of sense to keep this as the primary parking area. We've already met the requirements, and the leases will be very clear that there are only two parking spaces per dwelling unit. So the lease that's been submitted does have a two parking or two automobile limit already drafted into it. It's the understanding being though that lease is really a dwelling unit lease. If for some reason there were multiple leases associated with the unit, we would still you know, restrict the number of vehicles to 2 automobiles per dwelling unit.
All right. So I, that pretty much is your presentation, Mr. Burson, or is there anything else you'd like to discuss?
Are de minimis. The changes are de minimis. While there is some proposed disturbance of the exterior lot area, we don't believe it's going to be a substantial change to the site. If anything, we believe that it's going to give the town a better mechanism for enforcement if there are inspection and or issues related to the management of the property in the future, knowing that there is a designated property manager and point of contact for the site. And knowing that there's a special permit that if necessary, zoning enforcement could rely on, you know, with this property in the future. So it just seems from our perspective to make a lot of sense from an infill development standpoint, as well as its location off of Route 9 and its the bus stop, as well as its historic use in the neighborhood. So thank you.
So I have a couple of quick questions I'd like to go through, and then I'll open it up to board members. First, I know this has been to the Conservation Commission.
Yep.
Has the Conservation Commission considered, or do they need to consider any cut that you make in the for the second egress in the hillside that currently exists that you're going to have to cut back for the second egress into the basement? And have you gone to them, or will you need to go to them for measures to mitigate any effect on the conservation area?
Yeah, there was not concern from the Conservation Commission. Maureen, I believe you were at the meeting, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but primarily the actual resource areas that are being discussed here, and the context of those resource areas was certainly taken into account at the Conservation Commission, because the landfill was located directly to the east of this property. And it's not clear, to what extent the detention basin down there was a runoff area for that or what the purpose of it was. But additionally, the swale in the back, it wasn't totally clear whether it could be considered a resource area because there wasn't actually any flow there. So there wasn't much concern about this proposed project, particularly where there's already such a very concrete delineation between this lawned property area versus that vegetative buffer and then the steep drop to the that resource area.
So I guess my question, I didn't put it very well. The ConCom Commission approved this. Did they approve it with a cut? Had they known that you were going to make the cut in that hillside?
Oh yes.
When they approved it, it seemed like it was a new issue. Okay.
Yeah. Apologize for that. Yes.
Yeah. That's what I wanted to know.
The proposal included that the walkway and the cutout for it.
Walkway and the cutout. Good. All right. Secondly, I know there's an electrical inspector's letter regarding the fuse box. I used to call it a fuse box, but the circuit breaker on the wall for the basement and for the top, the first floor. Currently, I don't think it meets code, and I don't see that addressed in the floor plans. Is it going to be addressed, and how are you going to deal with that?
Yep. So I'm actually going to turn it over to Josh once again, because my understanding is that they've found a solution that's similar to, I guess, what they did with the 148. So I'll turn it over to him, and I'm certainly no electrical technician, so.
So yeah, we are going to move the electrical panel to the outside of the house and build a cabinet around it, because everybody needs access to it, both units. And that was the best way to do that. That has been run up through the electrical inspector, and she has approved that.
All right. Is that reflected on any plans that we have yet? Aren't any site plans or building plans that we have? This just must have just happened today. So this wouldn't be reflected on any plan.
It is not reflected on any plan, but we have, I believe there's an email between the electrician and the electrical inspector stating the plan and approval.
All right. We can certainly add that to the plan set, though, of course, and submit that prior to, you know, of course, yep, my expectation is that inspection services will require that from us.
Yep. So we want that on a plan. You talked about parking, so you're going
to need to have.
Yes.
Mr. Weskevitz has a comment.
Yes.
Yeah, I did speak to Tina today, and she did describe what they're talking about. So where you see the electrical panel located now, they would bring that out of the basement because it's too narrow to get back there to the panel. Plus, the other tenants on the first floor would not have access. So they're moving the electrical service to be outside with the breakers outside as well.
An overarching concern or question that I have is that we don't really have a site plan with dimensions for judging lot coverage, the amount of parking spaces, the length of the parking spaces, the square footage. We don't have that. And so that's a material part of, I would think it's a material part of the application. So we'd want to have a site plan. And I know you've talked to somebody, you'll have one for us, but we don't have one before us now. So it's hard for us to make judgments on whether you exceed the, if you exceed the lot coverage right now. So we need to have that, I think.
That's understandable. I mean, as I mentioned, we're happy to submit it. I think, we'd be happy to submit it if the board would consider a condition to that effect, because I believe we could get that into the town's hands very, very quickly.
Mr. Judge?
Yeah, Mr. Langsdale.
One quick thing. If they in fact are moving the electrical box to the outside, I think on the floor plan, the changes that they make, we need to then know what that little area is going to be used for where the box is right now.
Right. It should reflect, the floor plan should reflect what is actually going to happen. Correct?
Sure.
That's kind of a fundamental precept. All right. That's a good point, Mr. Langsdale. And then the last thing you talked about, you're going to try to delineate the residential manager's responsibilities.
I don't
see it in the management plan.
Yep. So I quite frankly, the list I have, it's very short because the primary responsibilities, as I mentioned, but I will submit that in writing to the board as a, you know,
part of the management
amendment
plan
to the application. Yep. And the management plan.
And that person will be on the complaint response form.
Yes. And I did want to address that, however, primarily because the process for updating the complaint response form, and this is my own ignorance because I haven't had to update them before. I generally just, you know, fill them out before these hearings. But as far as updating that person's name in the future, that's something that can be done at inspection services, doesn't require a formal process for the resident manager as opposed to the property manager.
I'm not sure I followed that.
So
I'm not sure I followed your point. Say it again.
My question, I guess, is if we need to update the complaint response plan because we update the resident manager, is that going to require us coming back for a public meeting, or can that be done at inspection services? Because it seems more of a administrative than.
Yeah, Maureen, I'm not sure if in this case it'll change in the fall when you have a new student potentially.
And that's my point.
So a condition. Go ahead, Maureen.
I could see that, you know, the board has two options. You could make a condition that when the complaint response plan and or the resident manager is changed, that either the applicant would update that information with inspection services, or if you want, you could make a condition that they would have to come back with the updated information at a public meeting. So those are the two
options we could do.
Two options that I think would work here.
Yep.
That you as the board should consider.
And we're obviously requesting that you guys allow us to hopefully get that changed if necessary through inspection services, but understanding that obviously this is the board's decision. So
I see Ms. O'Meara's hand raised. I don't know if that's intentional.
Real or not.
I'll raise my hand for real. I know we're far from any motions on this at this point, but while we're on the topic, I would definitely say my personal feeling would be for that to be something that inspection services would handle and not make them come back to the board. Yeah. I think feel that way.
Yes, Mr. Maxfield, that's how we've dealt with it in the past.
Okay,
it can be done. Yeah, it can be, not to burden us or burden them.
I have a question.
Ms. Parks.
I don't know if I'm not quite understanding, but I'm seeing that it's proposed 4 residential units and there's 4 parking spaces, but I'm counting 8 bedrooms. So are you intending to have 8 tenants or 4 tenants?
Yes, let me clarify that. So it's actually, so there's 2 dwelling units with 4 bedrooms in those respective units. So each unit of 4 bedrooms will only be allowed to have 2 cars. It works because of the fact right off the bus route, and it's primarily students who live there. Primarily the thinking being that each unit will only be entitled to 2 cars. They'll have to figure out amongst themselves as to who will actually be entitled to a vehicle.
Okay. So, but I'm reading here that, 1 parking space shall be provided for each room that's occupied. Is that something that we're waiving?
I apologize. My understanding is that the requirement is 2 spaces per dwelling unit.
Ms. Parks, where do you see that?
Well, I guess I'm looking at residential accessory uses for.
Oh, you're looking at the zoning bylaws?
Yeah, I'm looking at it. So Maureen, can you tell me in the zoning bylaws where the parking requirements are for rental units?
It should be section. Is it section 7?
I think it's 7. Yeah. I believe it's section 7.
Yeah, and so it would be page 82. It would be, get ready for this.
Okay, I see it.
7.0000. I just wanted to say that. And which is 2 parking spaces for each dwelling unit.
Dwelling unit.
Okay. I mean, I also do note that there's on-street parking there.
Yep.
Okay.
Other questions?
Oh. Yeah, I have
Mr. Langsdale?
Yeah. On the parking, you have, well, what we have shows 5 spaces.
Right.
We're talking about 4. But yep. Then there's the other park, the area right next to the house. What is that to be used for?
So the intent is, and it's a very good question, but the intent is to not have that be a parking space, to the primary parking be adjacent to the, where we had measured it out. And primarily because with this, the deck being put there, we're going to want to leave that just more open so that if people want to or need to, they can actually, leave off of the deck a little bit easier. I mean, the space is there. If we needed to, I guess we could claim it as a parking space, but the intent is not to use it as one.
So what are the dimensions of that space? Is it a 9x18?
Maureen, I don't have the, if you wanted to measure, I know it's not perfect with the GIS, but.
Sure, you want me to measure next to the. Yeah, I see what you're saying. Hold on.
I think he wants right next to the house, correct, the house. Keith?
It's approximately, well, that's right up to the house.
So, yeah, so,
10.
Yeah, so it's much bigger than a parking space.
Yeah. So if your intention is that for to not be one because
correct.
Of the egress from the deck, because you're building that stairway off of the deck to that area, what are you going to do to keep it from becoming a parking space?
I don't think the intent is to do anything with it.
It then becomes.
If the board has a preference, I mean, we can certainly add a condition. We hadn't considered it really, quite frankly.
Well, if it's something we need to consider, because if you're saying you have four parking spaces and you actually have five, then that's different than what your
regardless of your
management plan.
Or no, because regardless of what's physically there on the ground, we are only permitting four spaces. So each unit will only be entitled under the lease to two cars per unit. And that's something that's just going to, you know, will have to be enforced via the, you know, property management and the resident manager.
Okay. Well, can we make that a condition then, that it be, that it is not a parking space, and that it needs to be managed, that it, the parking is not permitted there? Because otherwise, it, I mean, it's there. It's, somebody's going to park there.
As I mentioned, it's
that.
Not a concern for us, but if it's a concern for the board, we're certainly, you know, open to it.
Okay, then on P1, which is existing floor plans, on the basement plan on the south side, it shows a window toward the west area, which is to remain with the changes. But it does not show the small window that's further toward the east side.
I'm looking at this.
Sorry, Keith, can you say, can you repeat that so I can pull it up?
P1, that's P2. Basement, yeah. So you have a window on the south side of the building, you have a window toward the west, which is to remain, but there's a window toward the east, which is not indicated on the plan.
I will let Josh speak to that window in the plans.
Okay, so I'm not following exactly. Which window doesn't exist?
Is it this one?
The one that's being
served.
No. This.
Let me do this again.
Oh, sorry.
On the south side of the building, toward the west, is this window that is to remain when the door egress is put in. But there is a small window, which I observed when we were there, that is on the eastern part of the south side, outside of bedroom. Well, it's seven. There aren't eight bedrooms there now. There are only six. So that would be, I don't know, three, four, five, bedroom five, I guess. But it's listed as bedroom seven. That's incorrect. So that window isn't indicated on this plan, nor is it indicated on P2, which is the floor plans for the renovations. Why isn't it there?
I don't think there's a window over there. I have some pictures.
There it is. I saw it.
Hey Josh, do you want to pull up the pictures so we can actually see which, you know, so you can physically see which window we're talking about? Because I know we do have
part of the reason I'm talking about this, because we weren't able to go inside, so couldn't really get a full understanding of what that inside of that building is, especially the basement. So sure. I need to know what that window is, and
you're right. I have a picture and that I'm looking at. There is a window in that bedroom. It's a small basement window. That was probably there originally. It would just be used for ventilation.
Well, my understanding would be that's the window that does not provide egress, so that's why you need to put the door in on the south side. Anyway,
I don't believe
that needs to be on the floor plan, and it needs on P1. It needs to be indicated on P2. If it's being removed, that needs to be indicated as well, or if it's remaining. That needs
sure.
to be.
Josh, just so I'm, is that where the new egress is going? I'm just curious if we can go back to that picture.
No.
I mean, I agree we should update the plan. I'm just.
Give me a second. Give me a second. Cause it's in my email. Oops, wrong. Sorry. Give me a moment. So this is, nothing's rotated, so bear with me.
So why don't, this is something that I think we can probably resolve by having a plan that accurately reflects.
We'll update the plan.
Yeah, we don't, right. I don't think we need to discuss regardless. This here. Why don't we have, why don't we, that is part of what we need, is we need site plans, we'll need an actual floor plan, we'll need the what the changes that Keith, that Mr. Langsdale represented, we need to have that. And that will help us to make a decision, right?
And the electrical, of course, updated as well.
Yep. Right. Is that satisfactory, Mr. Langsdale?
Yeah, for that, that's fine.
Yep, okay.
Now, the other thing is they're asking for a waiver of a lighting plan. There are now three areas that have lights on them. The west side, which is the front door, there's a light there that's a carriage style light. On the north side, there are two spotlights. On the east rear elevation, there is a light fixture above, it's attached to the upper part, the first floor
above
area.
Above the concrete, I recall.
And it's, I don't know what it is, but it's upside down. Then there is the light proposed for the new egress. So that'll be four light areas, all of which need to be dark sky compliant. The light in the east rear elevation right now would be, at least as far as I could tell, because once again, we didn't have full access. But as far as I can tell, the light that's there now would be somewhere close to the floor of the deck. So it has to be moved for one
correct.
Thing.
Correct.
But it has to be dark sky compliant.
And just so I'm clear, because obviously our intent had only been to replace. Oh, I'm sorry if you were coming in and out, so I wasn't sure if you were done or not, Keith.
Yeah, well, all I'm saying is that because of that, because you're applying for a special permit to make these changes, part of that has to be a lighting plot. And we have to not only see where they're going to go, but what they are, what your proposal is for those light changes.
Sure. So I'm more than happy to provide the board with fixture cut sheets. We can certainly just pick the lights that we choose to use and provide that to the board. I think a few things. One, I think originally our intent had been obviously not to change the lights that were already in existence there. But if the board's position is that all the lights need to be made dark sky compliant, we're more than happy to do that. And we're happy to provide you with the fixture cut sheets. We can do that. We can sit down this week and pick some lights. Okay. When I request the waiver, I guess specifically my concern is, I'm more than happy to show you where on the buildings those respective lights would go. I think by weighing of requesting the waiver, specifically what we were looking for is a waiver of submitting the photometric light plan and the whole nine yards. So, I mean, we're more than happy to provide fixture cut sheets as well as show the elevations with where those lights would be. I think the intent behind the waiver was more of to avoid the larger scale analysis plan. For all project, right?
Well, we can certainly make that a condition of the of anything with a special permit. Okay. So, are there any other questions from the board members? What I'd like to do is wrap up board member questions, any responses, open this up to the public if there's any, and then again, since we're getting on 9 o'clock, which is time when we typically wanted to stop this, we have. In the past, 9 has been the ending hour. We do have one. We'll see if we can get to our rules and regs quickly. If not, we'll suspend those as well. But I'd like to suspend this and continue it on to next week with the information that we need to get from the applicant. At a meeting and not at a hearing. Go ahead, Maureen.
Just real quick, Dave Wiskevitz has a comment, if you don't mind.
Yep. Yeah, I have actually a couple of questions, mostly in regards to that parking space that Keith was talking about. Where's the trash going to go? I don't know if that's been discussed. And then when that deck goes in place, people will need a pathway around it to get up to the parking lot. And since we don't have a site plan, I don't know where that is, what that path or that elevation's like, the incline, if there is any. Also lighting, because that deck is going to cast a shadow. You light above the deck, you light below the deck, but you're not going to have anything towards the stairs in that area. So do we need a lamp post, or was that, would that light that's maybe on that north side be enough? I don't know. So that's just some of the things I was thinking about.
And then real quick, I had one more to echo off of Dave is, I did see where the trash is. It is in the sort of fifth parking spot, if you will.
Which we could stop calling it the parking spot.
Yeah,
let's
right.
Stop calling it the parking spot.
I do have photos. It does not look. It does not look enclosed, and I. That might be something that the applicant might want to just
want to think about.
And we might be able to tie those two things together, the parking issue with the trash receptacles. So just to eliminate the concern there, because it clearly is a concern. So noted. And we'll certainly update the lighting and the site plans accordingly.
Hey, may I step in a second?
One last, yes, Mr. Langfield.
Yep. Given this picture that's up right now that Maureen has put up, you have there four trash receptacles and two bicycles. So instead of a parking area for a car, why don't you put a bike rack there along with an enclosure for these receptacles? And that way you'll have, if any of your tenants, well, obviously some of them ride bicycles, you'd have a place for their bicycles to be stored.
Definitely not a bad idea. I will speak with Elsie about potential solutions for that spot, because that is a good one.
Okay.
Are there any other questions?
I guess
Mr. Axfield.
Yeah, I guess I just want to know with the fifth parking spot that we're no longer referring to it as the place formerly known as the fifth parking spot. Before we have these guys come back with any sort of plan, is it that we want it mandated in what they're bringing back, that it's specifically not going to be used as a parking lot? Because I know they're required to have four. They have four. And if they have more space where, let's say, I don't know, it's one of the tenants' birthdays and they're going to have a bunch of people come in and park and blocking people in, like, are they going to be, do we want to put any type of stipulation where they'd be in violation?
Quite frankly. And not to cut you off, quite frankly, we're not concerned about the parking because, as it was mentioned, there's more than adequate on-street parking. Mm-hmm. Particularly where this is the last house on the street, and there's the entire, drainage basin lot leading up to Route 9 that's totally, empty street as well. So, I mean, if the concern is with people utilizing as a spot, I mean, from a parking standpoint, if there are guests, we feel that there's adequate space, in and around the location to adequately meet any of those needs.
Okay. Yeah. I bring this up because my concern is I don't feel we should be more burdensome than we need to be if it's not necessary for us to put a stipulation on what that spot is used for, because we know it's not zoned specifically for parking. They have the four spots that meet our criteria. So I just don't know if that's something we really want to push on or not. Or if it would just be better to just kind of let it be.
I think in this case we should let the applicant come back to us with what they want, and then we can review that and see if it meets our requirements. But I understand the point you're making. There's no reason to deny them an additional parking spot if they really want one on their land, a fifth parking spot.
As I mentioned, we're not concerned, but there the trash should be screened, so those are things that we will have to address. So,
all right. Good enough. Good point. Any other? If there are no other questions from members of the board, Maureen, is there anybody from the public that is attending that wants to make a point? If there is anybody from the public, raise your hand or indicate that you wish to speak to this.
I see okay. no hands Nobody, being raised.
I see no hands. So what I'd like to do is to continue this meeting until the July 9th. And at that time, ask the applicant to come back with a full site plan, come back with the lighting cut sheets, come back with a plan for the site plan. Should we also incorporate what you want to do with the enclosure, and if you want to add a bike rack or not, or however you want to deal with that formerly, what's the sure. place formerly known as parking spot 5, and also to have your plan reflect the actual work to be done, both interior on the interior and the exterior. So that would be what I think those would be the requirement. That are the requirements that I think you should have for next meeting. And with that, I would move that we continue this hearing until July 9th. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion on that motion? If not, roll call vote. I vote aye. Ms. Parks, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Maxfield, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
Mr. O'Meara, Miss O'Meara. You're muted, Miss O'Meara.
Can you unmute me, Maureen?
Oh, we heard you. Just say aye.
Aye. Aye, aye.
All right. Motion passes. We will continue this until July 9th. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Normally we like to close these off to the members of the board. I want to say normally we like to close these off at 9 o'clock at night. That's a long time. This was a particularly detailed meeting. I would like to get people's impression if they have a lot of questions about the rules and regulations. We can go over them. We have John Witten on the line with us. He's an attorney that's helped draft this. I have reviewed these. I have looked at the changes. They are minor except for the large change in adding all the procedures for the comprehensive permit. But if people have a lot of, if they want to discuss this and want to spend an hour on this, I would suggest we move this to another date. But if you don't have a lot of questions, if this isn't something that you think we need to discuss, and you'd like to approve these rules and regulations, that would be my preference. And we can ask John to do a very, very brief summary of the significant changes in the rules and go from there. So first of all, I'd like to get a sense of the board. And if we're going to wait, it's going to be a long meeting, then we'll postpone it. If it's going to be a short meeting, I'd like to have him go through the summary. Mr. Maxfield.
I mean, my personal preference is I've read through it. I haven't gotten as much of a chance to go through it as thoroughly as I would have liked to. So before we even get started, if other people are feeling maybe we want to postpone this before we get into a big discussion about it, I'm in favor of it. That being said, I know we have John Witten here, and if we have to then make him come back another day and we just want to go through it, I could go either way. But if it's not difficult to postpone it, that would be my preference. If it is, I'm still ready to move forward on it nonetheless.
My preference would be to you would like to have more information, but you don't know that you have a lot of concerns at this point because you need more information. That's
correct.
Okay. All right. Any of the board members have grave concerns about the regulations, rules and regulations as submitted to you last week? So I think we'll take, barring that, I think we'll take the opportunity for John Witten to go through briefly the changes, and then there's one item I'd like to discuss at the end in the comprehensive permit, but there's not much else that I think needs to be that I need to address. I think John can address the major changes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm on my cell phone. Can everyone hear me okay? Can you hear me okay, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. So The most significant changes to this really second round of proposed changes is to strengthen the regulations so that the board can require the submission of materials that the board needs to review a comprehensive permit. so that the board can be clear to the applicant what the requirements are for waivers, and so that the board can make clear to the applicant what's required in terms of the pro forma review. There's a lot more detail in the draft regs than that, but those are really kind of the macro concerns that I believe the draft addresses. Plan requirements, filing requirements, issues relating to waivers, and then issues relating to the pro forma. You know, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being very aggressive, 1 being not aggressive at all, the draft regs are right in the middle. I think they're 5 or 6. They're consistent with regs from across the Commonwealth. They are a big step forward, I think, to the regs that you currently have. And in terms of really laying out the framework for what an applicant needs to do for filing with the Board of Appeals. So, Mr. Chairman, I know the hour is late, and I know the board's been at this since 6 o'clock. So let me stop there, and I can address any specific questions that you might have, however you'd like to proceed.
Well, John, why don't I do this? I will run through what I see were sort of procedural changes as to how the board itself operates. And they're minor, but I think that would be important to advise the board about. And then to the extent that people want to talk about the public interface, the biggest places in the comprehensive permit, we can talk about that as well. But I think it's just important to go through the way the board operates itself. There's only a couple of changes, a few changes. The first is we delete the requirement that there's a majority vote, a unanimous vote needed to for plans, signs, and other items as a condition of a public meet, as a condition of a special permit at a public meeting. And we just make it a 4-vote majority. In effect, I think this was a carryover from when we had a 3-member board. It seems to me that since we use a 4-vote majority to make a decision on a special permit, I don't know why we need to have a unanimous vote to approve signs and other items which are set as a condition of a special permit. I think a 4-vote is consistent with other things.
Mr. Chair, if you don't mind clarifying what page you are, I have just found it. Referring to it.
I'm not working, Maureen, I'm not working off the one you sent because I have not used track changes for about 10 years, and it's so different that I can't really figure it out.
Okay, all right, we'll try your best. The best. So what he's referring to is on page 3, the last line of page 3.
Yeah, that's on this one too. It's the last line of page 3. A board may seek clarifying information from the public if it's necessary, and we delete the unanimous vote of all members of the board as necessary for approval of signs and other items required by condition attached to the existing permit. That's the first one. We make the same change. We go from a unit. This one, I'll try to give you the page, Maureen. On page, this one deals with the approval of an extension request. So an applicant has submitted an extension request. I think is that on page 7?
It's on page 7, correct.
On page 7. An applicant, go ahead, Maureen.
Oh, just under the section that's entitled extensions.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. We've even gone through my earphones. It's a long time. So what we've done here is if an applicant has extended a written agreement to extend the approval, ask for an extension request. I see no reason why that has to be a unanimous vote. A 4-member vote seems to make sense again, which is what we take for everything. There's no reason that we require a supermajority because an applicant, and we agree, wants to extend a application. Another change on how the board operates is we have inserted language that requires that any material that is considered material that is substantive a change before meeting, any material that would reflecting a change in plans, reflecting a change in any material change in the application, be submitted to the board 7 days before the meeting, so that we're not caught in the situation where we're getting stuff at the last minute and things like site plans or management plans or lighting plans are submitted the last day. And I think that I think 7 days gives us time and the staff time to look at it, review it, and for us to consider it. It does provide that we can deem these to be non-material, and that's at the chairman's judgment. But so I don't want it for something little. I don't want to hold up a permit. But I think for something material to the application, we should have 7 days of notice and to view the property, view the material. And those are the major changes in how the board operates itself that are contained in these rules and regs. Any questions or concerns about that from members of the board? If not, John, do you want to briefly describe, it's too long to describe, I think, the whole comprehensive permit procedures and what we can ask for. But I think if you give an overview of why the requirements are as specific as they are and how that helps not only us, but it helps the applicants to know what the comprehensive permit, what could be required. Everything that's on this, on the comprehensive permit procedures is something we could do without this. This is all within our power currently. What we've done here is you know, codified what I think this is right, and correct me if I'm wrong, John. We've codified what we want to have from the applicant and what our rights are as a board to ask for information.
John, that's absolutely right, Mr. Chairman. And the thing about the comprehensive permit process is most of the time the applications are very preliminary, more often than not incomplete, and the board really has its back against the wall from the get-go. So these draft regs put the applicant on notice that these are the minimum requirements that the board needs to adjudicate a comprehensive permit. They're not onerous. They're consistent with your normative special permit filing requirements or planning board filing requirements, but they're specific and they go into some level of detail. As the chair says, yes, you could require these things anyway, case by case, but it's always better for the applicant and for the public to lay it out as part of a regulatory process. Here's what needs to be filed from day one, so you're not stuck asking for things 6 months or 6 weeks into a project. So the filing requirements are pretty standard. I don't consider the draft overly aggressive. The board will be very specific on different cases, a rental project, for example, versus a for sale project, big versus small. But I do think you want to have details in the application requirements, and that's what the draft does.
I would open it up to questions or to a sense of the board. If you have specific questions about any of either the operational or the comprehensive permit changes, please raise them now. Or if the sense of the board is that you really want to spend more time on this and and move it to another meeting, we can do that as well. But
Mr. Chair, Christine Brestrup, the planning director, is indicating she has a comment.
Go ahead, Christine.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just have a comment on page 14, the beginning of the comprehensive permit description under introduction. And I objected to the language in the first line of that, of the second paragraph there. So page 14.
Is this the right page? Is this the page you're looking at, Chris?
No.
It's page 19.
Article 4, additional rules and regulations for governing the filing of applications for a comprehensive permit. There you go, that pink language. So I think taking out the words comprehensive permit would solve my objection. The thing is that I am reluctant to say that the town encourages comprehensive permit applications. So if we took out the words comprehensive permit and just left the town encourages applications for housing or mixed use developments that serve low, moderate, and middle income households, I would be happy with that. But I'm a little nervous about saying that the town encourages comprehensive permit applications, even though I know that the intent of the language here is to say, we encourage applications for housing and mixed use that serve low and moderate income. But I don't want to encourage a lot of comprehensive permit applications to come here, come to us. So that would be my suggestion.
I think that's a good suggestion, Christine. Ms. Brestrup, that's a good suggestion. There's also another, there's another question that we have that we wanted to have for board discussion. And John, this is one at the end of, it's on page 27, I think. It's the one where the board shall, upon separate motion and seconded prior vote, approve of any non-residential or structure within a comprehensive permit application by a form of vote of no fewer than four members. So this is, you know, I think what'd be helpful is explain the situation that this applies to. We have a, oh, I'm sorry. This is not the one is this the one that deals with, yes, this is the one with non-residential use. Yeah. Explain the situation we're facing here.
So the comprehensive permit statute deals with housing and only housing. When the regulations were revised about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, they included a provision that allows a comprehensive permit to be issued that included non-residential use. The regs say that the non-residential use has to be ancillary to the residential use, but of course, that is a very subjective statement. So I suggested this language for the board's consideration that if the board wanted to allow a non-residential component within a comprehensive permit, that it would do so, but the quantum of vote would be higher, just to provide the town slightly greater protection. Because while a comprehensive permit clearly is going to need waivers from zoning, none of us ever expected that that would include a non-residential component, a retail store, for example. So my suggestion here is if the board wanted to include 6.10, that you would include it with a higher level of, or a higher quantum of vote requirement. And that's really all. You don't have to do that. Right now it's a majority vote of the board, so 3 out of 5. This would make it 4 out of 5, more like a special permit. And my only support for that is because it's so extraordinary to consider that a comprehensive permit not only is asking for waivers for zoning density for residential use, but could also allow a Board of Appeals to grant a retail use within, you know, a mixed use within the residential use. So that's really the theory, and nothing more than that.
And John, is this... only in the case of a non-residential use in an area where there can be a non-residential use without a special permit being necessary.
So yeah.
This is the case where non-residential uses could be approved by without a special permit.
By right, yes.
By right. And we would be saying non-residential uses in this district need a 4-person vote of the board in order to permit it. Is that correct?
Correct. As part of a comprehensive permit. That's correct.
As part of a comprehensive permit. And in addition, a comprehensive permit is for approval, takes 3 votes, not 4 votes by state law. Correct?
That's correct.
So this is, a supermajority for something that, in my opinion, a supermajority for something that is otherwise provided for by right. And that is the, and I'm wondering, I'd like to throw that open to the board for their discussion. My inclination is to not have this section in there, but I would like to throw it open to the board because non-residential uses sometimes will be controversial and we may want to have a higher standard.
Okay, I guess I'm a little confused. This section that Mr. Witten has proposed to put in with the no fewer than four voting members, that gives us more control, right?
Okay. It does.
So are you saying that you don't think this should be in there?
Well, I'm saying that this only applies in a case where a non-residential use is already allowed by right. And it seems odd to me that we are going to condition a non-residential use in a comprehensive permit by a supermajority vote of the board when it is something that could be done without having any kind of permit at all. And that seems to me to be, I don't understand the theory behind that. And that's why
Mr. Chair, let me. Yes. No, it's a very fair question. Let me just take it a step further. So yes, it's true. I could build this non-residential structure and use today by virtue of just getting a building permit. But in this context, under 6.10, it would be part of a comprehensive permit where I come to the board for, let's say, 100 dwelling units. And on the ground floor, I'm going to have 3,000 square feet of retail space. I could get that retail space by right, but I can't get the comprehensive permit by right. So when I want to mix these two uses, 6.10 would come into play. It is true that I could apply for the retail use today, and then 3 months later, apply for a comprehensive permit around it. But that's unlikely to happen. We don't typically see that kind of segmentation. So the reason for kind of raising the bar is because I am coupling two uses that one allowed by zoning, but the other, at least in terms of density, not allowed by zoning. So it gives the Board of Appeals kind of a superintendency over the whole thing. That's really the purpose.
Mr. Chair, Ms. Brestrup has a comment.
Ms. Brestrup.
So the reason that you might want to support this is because there might be something about the non-residential use that requires a waiver. So say they wanted to, have more lot coverage, or they wanted to have less of a setback, or, you know, if the non-residential use is on the ground floor of a building that's not complying with the dimensional requirements, you might want to have the ability to have four members voting to allow that to occur. Because even though the use is allowed in the district, it could be that there's an aspect of the waivers that you want to be particularly careful about. So I just wanted to point that out.
And Mr.
Barrick.
Eric, yeah, I think I agree with John Witten's suggestion. I take it that the purpose of Section 40B is to encourage affordable housing. And if you're including retail space in it, that's whether or not it's desirable, it's not affordable housing. And it seems to me reasonable to require a somewhat higher standard for creating the mixed project than it is for creating the housing that's the purpose of Section 40B.
I think the context that that Ms. Bresta and Mr. Witten have provided changes my thought here a little bit. I hadn't thought of it in that way, and I just saw it as a limitation on something that would be otherwise permitted. But I see that this gives us the ability to leverage the comprehensive permit in a way that we otherwise couldn't as a board. And I think that does make some sense. And I think your point, Mr. Barrick, is a good one as well. So I remove my objection to this, and I remove my motion to to delete this section and allow it, I would suggest it stays. Is there any other discussion on this section? You did have a, Ms. Brestrup, you made a suggestion to move, to remove two words, and we didn't vote on that. But I think that I would move that we accept your deletion of those two words of comprehensive permit early on and change that. I think we need a, as all, we need a roll call vote for all this stuff. So for Ms. Brestrup's motion to delete the words comprehensive permit in the introduction, second paragraph introduction of the comprehensive permit section, I would move that. Is there a second?
Second.
All those, is there any further discussion?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I just, what was the exact rationale of why we wanted to remove that? It's because we just don't want to encourage necessarily comprehensive permits as a way of achieving affordable housing? Is that the reasoning to remove that line?
Correct, but I'll let Chris.
Yep.
You want me to speak to that?
Yes, please, please speak to that.
I think we welcome comprehensive permits in town, but I don't think we want to advertise it. And this sort of advertises it. And comprehensive permits are really, you know, a difficult process to get through. And there's often a lot of objection by residents. And I think by stating we encourage comprehensive permit applications, even though that's not the entire meaning of the sentence, yeah, I think makes us sort of vulnerable to people saying, well, you said you encouraged these applications. So my preference would be leave out the words comprehensive permit and then just say, we encourage applications for housing or mixed use development that serve these populations in general. And I think that's enough of a statement.
Mm-hmm. I think we as a board are gonna see how involved and time consuming this comprehensive permit process is. I have not been through one, but I've talked to people that have, and we have a lot of work ahead of us. And it's a great tool that should be used, but I don't think we have to, as Ms. Brestrup said, I don't think we have to advertise it. Mm-hmm. I think this achieves our goal.
I have a basic question here.
Yes, Mr. Meadows.
You've been referring to four votes as being a majority.
Before,
as you look at Article 1, the definition of the board is 5 regular and 4 members, which is a total of 9, which would mean a majority is 5.
Oh. Well,
so either we have to change that the definition, or we have to change the indication of majority of what?
So you're talking about Section 1 members and officers.
Yes.
You have 5 regular and 4 associate members. And then farther down, we describe when there's a panel, there's a panel of 5.
Right. I'm talking about in that paragraph, it indicates that the majority, it doesn't say majority of the regular members.
Oops.
Oh, well, it says majority vote is required to adopt or approve business matters covered by this section. So
Mr. Chairman, maybe I could just throw this out. It's an excellent question that a Board of Appeals consists of no more than 5 members. And so a quorum of 5 would be 3. And by statute, a variance and a special permit requires a supermajority vote when the board consists of more than 3. So a majority vote for a 5-member board, which is what you are, even though you have associate members, they are not considered part of the board in terms of calculating what a quorum or a majority would be. So you are always a 5-member body, even though you have 4 associate members. So a majority vote of 5 would be 3, and then the supermajority vote for a special permit and a variance would be 4. And when it's a comprehensive permit, it is a simple majority or 3.
Would there be something in terms of talking about the sitting members of the board, which are five, no matter if they're associate members or not?
You could. It's not ambiguous to me, just because of the way the state statute is written. 48 section 12 describes a board of appeals. So we know, you know, it's a technical term, associate members. We know that they only get to vote or have their vote count when one of the five regular members is not available. So you are a five member body. You certainly could put in more detail, but I don't think you have to.
Mr. Meadows, does that answer your question?
I think so.
Any other questions on the rules and regulations? Mr. Burek.
I hate to bring this up. On page 3, and I can't find the passage on my screen, but I can describe what my concern is. There's a list in the list of who has to, which abutters have to be notified. It says that an invitation should go to other interested parties, with other interested parties not otherwise specified. And I'm just wondering if that opens us up at some point to challenging a decision for not having notified someone who considers herself or himself an interested party. John Whitten, you could probably clarify whether this is worth worrying about.
Yeah, no, it's an excellent question. So the phrase interested parties could come out. I think that's in your existing regs. So I just left that alone. But you're right, it is an ambiguity. I would take it out. I think the original intent probably was someone provided the board with a notice, please let me know when you have a hearing in this matter. But it does, it's not necessary. You certainly could take it out.
Can you point me to the paragraph, Mr. John Whitten?
Yeah, section 1 under article 2, Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
And it's the last sentence.
2.2 under public hearings.
And it's shown on the screen, if that's helpful.
Yes, that is helpful.
I mean, based on what you described, we want to just change that language to say, and any parties who have formally expressed interest, so that way they've come to us and said they're interested rather than retroactively saying, hey, I was an interested party and you never contacted.
Yeah, you could, you know, it's funny that we're having this conversation because in a sense, the world has changed, you know, so no one gets mailed an agenda anymore. The board under the open meeting law can choose how it wants to post its agendas. So I wonder whether the board really wants to be bound by that full sentence even. I didn't want to mess with your existing language on that as far as that went, but you know, now that we're talking about it, the paragraph we're looking at that Maureen has on the screen, that first paragraph, last sentence, I would suggest delete it. The board's going to send the agenda to the town manager and the building commissioner anyways. You don't want to be punished if you don't.
So that this paragraph would end after legal holidays.
Yeah, no, I would keep the next sentence, unless otherwise stated notification is not required, and then delete the next sentence.
The what I'm highlighting or in gray.
Agenda, board meetings and hearings.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. The goal here would be to just make it permissive and not a requirement.
Exactly.
Accomplish that by deleting it or by changing the nature of the sentence to be a purely permissive sentence.
Yeah, I almost think
80 Steve, cents. Yeah,
I almost
get rid of it.
Yeah, I'd get rid of it. I can't imagine a court entertaining an appeal because someone forgot to send the agenda to the town manager. But why leave that open?
And Ms. Brestup, is there any thing that in terms of a organizational issue that we shouldn't delete this?
Yeah. No, I think it's fine to delete it.
Good, let's do that.
I have a suggestion.
Okay, so we need a vote on that, don't we?
Yeah, so it seems that we have three possible votes that maybe we can absorb into one motion, if that would allow. Because we have to do the roll call. So one being this highlighted one, the other would be deleting the two words that said comprehensive permit that Chris spoke about. And then do folks want to vote on, make a motion on the section regarding non-residential uses, which was on page 18, I think.
Non-residential uses, that was the one Steve was talking about that he withdrew his motion on, am I correct?
Right.
I'm gonna go ahead and, because I believe there's already a motion to remove remove those two words, the motion that Steve had made earlier, which was seconded, which we were still technically currently discussing. I'm gonna move to amend that to also include the removal of that last sentence, that section one, public meetings, agendas for board meetings and hearings drawn up, citizen staff, so on and so forth, sent to the town manager, building commissioner, and any party, to also remove that sentence as well.
Is there a second to his motion to amend?
Second.
All right, further discussion on that? All right. Are there other, well, we can dispose of your amendment and then continue to amend the original amendment if we want, or we can continue on with a third amendment, which is not parliamentary procedure, but it saves us having to make a bunch of votes. So are there other suggested changes that we can incorporate as an amendment to his amendment? I'm not hearing any. In that event, then I will move that we accept Mr. Maxfield's amendment to the amendment previously to my amendment. Do I have a second to that?
Second.
Any further discussion? I vote aye. Ms. Parks, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Maxfield, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
Ms. O'Meara?
Aye.
Motion passes. Now we come to the amendment as amended.
Are
there any other amendments that to the rules or regulations that people want to consider that we can incorporate into one vote? If not, go ahead, Ms. Parks.
I'm sorry, I just want to ask a question. I'm sorry, it's I just don't know.
Can I just say something real quick?
Yeah.
While you're finding, so I'm going to go ahead and delete this, accept this deletion. If you guys see it,
wait until we finish the amendment because we just amended the amendment. We have a final vote of the amendment. To vote.
Oh, sorry. I thought you approved it. Nope. Sorry.
We're still we have the amendment as amended before us.
Got it.
So, I just have a question.
Okay.
And that is under time requirements for use of construction. I know that there is a time period by which people must commence construction, but is there a deadline by which they must finish it once they've started?
So, excellent question. And the board is going to most likely want to put that as a condition permit by permit, as opposed to having it in your regs. I'll tell you, just because it's such an important question, and because you have a hearing coming up, when a permit is about to lapse, the applicant will come in and ask for a continuation. So the board can impose a deadline, but it 99% of the time is going to get at least petitioned to be revised. So I don't think you need to put it in the regs. What Maureen is showing is that is for, I think that's for a special permit, Maureen, isn't it?
Yeah, probably.
For 48. Yeah. So it'll be permit by permit on the comprehensive permit. The statute or the regs say 3 years, but you're going to want to deal with that case by case.
Okay. And I guess I was just thinking about someone who starts a project but doesn't finish it.
Yeah, yeah, and that's not uncommon, and you know, certainly that's what we just saw happen starting, you know, from February to March. So the when the board reviews the comprehensive permit, there'll be bonding or performance guarantee requirements. There'll be surety requirements as part of that. But yeah, you do want to worry about a project that gets halfway completed and then the developer either goes bankrupt or leaves town. And that's typically done through surety.
And as a follow-up to that, Tammy, often the board will make it a condition of the special permit. For instance, that, you know, from the issuance of the building permit, the construction needs to be completed within 24 months or something like that. And if it's not, then the applicant needs to come back to a public meeting to either a public meeting or a public hearing. I forget how we do that, but to explain why they need more time.
All right, I've seen deadlines for starting the project. I just didn't see deadlines for ending the project. And one other thing was that in all of our procedures here, do we want to add anything about this unusual circumstance, like about Zoom meetings and having to do roll calls and whatnot? I didn't see anything for that. Not that I'm saying we should add it, just throwing it out.
You know, I'm kind of thinking that we're going to experience this for the next couple of months, and I think we'll have a better sense of how we should amend our rules. And I think we'll have to do it again in the fall and in the winter, maybe. So I think let's spend some time. We can go back and reamend these rules again, but I think we should gather some experience with it before we put something in, you know, cold hard black letter law.
Sounds good.
Okay. So we have before us the amendment as amended by Mr. Maxfield to amend the rules and regulations. And it's been seconded, and there's been discussion. It's now time for a vote on that amendment as amended. And this can be a roll call vote. So I vote aye. Ms. Parks?
Aye.
Mr. Maxfield?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
Ms. O'Meara?
Aye.
If there are no other amendments, discussions, or comments, I think we've reached the end of the rules, consideration of the rules and regulations for the ZBA. And if that's the case, I move that we adopt these rules and regulations for the ZBA. Is there a second?
Seconded.
Any further discussion? If not, this is a roll call vote. I vote aye. Ms. Parks, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Maxfield, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
Ms. O'Meara?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. Thank you all for that. And thank you, John, for your help.
My pleasure. Thank you all.
Restrup and Ms. Pollock, thank you for a lot of work on these rules and regulations. It was, I can tell you that I spent some time on it. They spent a lot of time on it, and it's tedious work, and they deserve our thanks. So
thank you.
And thank you, John.
My pleasure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That comes to the end of the end of the items on the agenda. The only thing left for this meeting is to open it up for public comment for items not on the agenda, which we have to do for every meeting. And Maureen, is there anybody still listening? anybody?
No one. Zero.
Comment? All right.
Zero.
There is no public comments at 10 to 10 at night. So Matt, I move we adjourn the meeting of this meeting. Is there a second?
Seconded.
All right. I vote aye. If no further discussion, I vote aye. Ms. Parks?
Aye.
Mr. Maxfield?
Aye.
Mr. Langsdale?
Aye.
Ms. O'Meara?
Aye, aye.
Aye, aye. Thank you all. We'll try to return to our 9 o'clock limit in the future, or maybe 9:30 in the future. I think that's enough, but I appreciate your time, patience, and all your input for these last three items. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Have a good evening.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.